I'd like to call to order the meeting of the Twin Falls City Council for Monday, August 8th. We were able to get our technical issues taken care of a little more quickly, so we'll go ahead and get our meeting started. Those of you wishing to join me for the Pledge of Allegiance, please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We do have a quorum of the council here. All seven members are with us this evening. Mr. Rothweiler, are there any amendments to the agenda?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, there are two amendments that staff would ask that the council consider. The first is the addition of a request to approve the Cycle Magic Valley Bicycle Ride sponsored by MavTech, which is the Magic Valley Trail Enhancement Committee. This is an event that is going into its second year. This is an item that we should have included in the initial calendar for consent, and we inadvertently left that off. And so we would ask the council to add that this evening, and we have individuals here that can talk about the event if there is of interest. The second item is that we would ask that the executive session that is scheduled for the end of the meeting be postponed.
Council wishes on Chris Talkington.
Move acceptance of the consent calendar as amended.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion to accept the consent calendar with the addition of the Cycle Magic Valley Bicycle Ride. Motion by Chris Talkington, seconded by Don Hall. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Don Hall?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. So we will back up on the agenda now. Always confuses us when we have an amendment to the consent calendar. We have no proclamations, so next on the agenda is general public input. So we have several people who are signed up, some on a specific item. So we'll go to Lucy Wills. Did you want to speak on a specific agenda item or just general public input? So you're first on the list. You're welcome to come forward. So just a reminder of our procedures that we will limit comment to 3 minutes per person this evening. You need to be recognized by the mayor. State your address for the record, your name and address, and please state whether you are a resident of or own property in the city of Twin Falls.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council, and everyone else in the audience. I don't have much prepared tonight. My address, before I go on, is 816 Cherokee Lane. I am a resident of Twin Falls, of the city of Twin Falls in Twin Falls County. I don't have much prepared tonight, and in fact, my husband said that what I do have, I sound angry, and I am. I read about the activist who came to town to create more hate and discontent among our citizens of our city, and I'm sorry that you continue to endure this nonsense, given that you do not have oversight over the agency or the group that they are opposed to. I again want to reiterate that your presence here at this venue is a menace to those conducting business here, and although you, the City Council, as elected officials, need to maintain diplomacy and treat all citizens with respect, I frankly lack both diplomacy and patience right now for this continued nuisance that continues to present itself here. I get no pleasure or satisfaction out of coming here on a weekly basis to defend our community and how this group represents only a very small portion of it. But I feel that sitting in the gallery and listening to how they represent my town is appalling, and that is why I am here again revisiting you tonight. I am also repulsed at the continued use and reference to an innocent five-year-old child who endured a horrendous act so that they can further their agenda. And this little girl will forever be known as the little girl who. And That is appalling to me as a counselor, as a woman, and as a, someone who was molested herself. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Wells. Denise Alexander. So, Denise, you were here for the bike thing, right? Okay. You're welcome to address us as well, if you'd like. Okay. So next we have Terry Edwards. Welcome, Mr. Edwards.
Welcome, Mayor. Respect must be earned. Honesty is appreciated. Trust is gained. Only then will respect and loyalty be returned. The truth about Islam was presented by our guest, Brigitte Gabriel, to more than 700 fellow residents in the Magic Valley. None of you took advantage of our personal invitation to educate yourself about creeping Sharia, cultural jihad, and hijra, as well as the Muslim Brotherhood, a known terrorist organization operating in Twin Falls. I want to present to each of you a document entitled An Explanatory Memorandum on the General Strategic Goal of the Group in North America, authored by a member of the Board of Directors for North American Muslim Brotherhood. This important document is a blueprint for the Muslim Brotherhood in America, and it was discovered among 80 bank boxes of archived documents and entered as evidence by the FBI in 2008 federal case, United States versus the Holy Land Foundation, a Muslim Brotherhood front group, among others. Please enlighten yourselves to methods and goals contained in this insidious subversion of our Constitution, the laws of our country, and our culture that is contained in this document. Pay special attention to the last page of the affiliate organizations. I have included the English and Arabic text. Mr. Hall, you can have your Arabic-speaking friends at the Twin Falls Police Department verify the accuracy of the English translation that was previously accepted by a federal court. I'd like to pass this out to you. And
so if you're going to continue to address us, you need to do that at the podium because the meeting is streamed.
I'm going to pass this out to each one of you, and you can verify it. It's got the evidentiary government exhibit stamp on the front, and in my presentation I gave you the case that it was involved in. So you should just enlighten yourself with what their goal is, and that goal is here in Twin Falls.
Mr. Edwards. And next I have Lee Stranahan.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Lee Stranahan. I'm from Dallas, Texas. I'm the lead investigative reporter for Breitbart News. We're one of the leading websites on the internet. And I've come here to Twin Falls to cover the controversy about the Fonbrook rape and the refugee issue. I sent an email both to former Mayor Hall and to Mayor Berger a few days ago. At the time, I thought I was only going to be here a few days. I'm going to be here through Friday. And I sent an interview request to you both, and I'd like to restate that again formally. I would like to interview both of you to cover, again, the controversy about what's going on. Particularly, I'm curious about the economic background that led the refugees to be here in the first place. I'm familiar with the refugee issue. I went to Beirut in 2013. I was one of the first people to report on the Syrian refugee crisis. I interviewed people from the UNHCR over there. And so it's an area I'm familiar with. And specifically, though, I'm very curious about the economic benefits to industry for hiring refugees and how that program came into play. So That's really it. Like I said, I would like to formally ask both the mayor and the former mayor, if you have time. I'm here Friday. If you can't do it then, I'm sure they'll extend my stay. And that's it. I appreciate your time. Thanks very much.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Stranahan. I will certainly get back to you on your request. So next, I think that's with, is it Joe? I can't read your last name, Joe, but I think you're with Western Waste Service, so I assume you're here for the item later on the agenda?
Yes.
Okay. Brad Wills, you're signed up under public input.
Mayor and members of the City Council, I've been coming for the last couple of months as just an observer to see what's been going
on. Brad, could you state your address for the record, please, and whether you're
a resident of Twin Falls? I am Brad Wills. I'm at 816 Cherokee Lane in Twin Falls, and I am a resident in the city of Twin Falls.
Thank you.
So one thing that I've noticed in all this is that we do have people that are very passionate about items enough that they come here every week, too. And so one suggestion I know is that we have a lot of committees, and if you really want to be involved in the city of Twin Falls and what goes on here, there are 12 commissions that are in, that we have vacancies usually for people that want to give in to, and most of the people before me have all served in these things, but there is an airport advisory, a building inspection, development impact, golf advisory, historical preservation, improvement reimbursements, planning and zoning, parks and rec, traffic and safety, their urban renewal board, youth council, economic development, and senior citizens. So there's a lot of places that if you have the need to be involved and to make Twin Falls a better community, which is why I think you're all here tonight, I would encourage you to get more involved in the different opportunities that we have here. And I would just want to make sure that each of you people are pillars of the community. You're so transparent that it bothers me sometimes because we don't have to know everything, but I just want to let you know that no matter what's said, I think each one of you are honorable people. You've earned your right in Twin Falls, and I really appreciate all the hard work you guys do. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Wills. So that is all of the people who I have signed up to speak in the public input portion of the agenda. If there is anyone who came in after the list was removed who would like to address the council, you're welcome to come forward now.
My name is Jesse Stroop. I live in Twin Falls. I'm a resident.
Welcome, Jesse.
And I think I asked this question maybe a couple months ago, and I asked if you guys had walked through the refugee housing across from the police station, and I just wanted to see if anybody had done that. And if you haven't, I just want to re-encourage you guys to do that because it's kind of appalling the state that they're living in right now. And I think that's something that really needs to be addressed. It probably should be a top priority because these are human beings and they're living in squalor. So if you go and look at that and just see what they're living in, I think it would kind of maybe open your eyes to this issue. So that's all. Thanks.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to address the council on the open agenda?
Howdy. I'm Nolan Stroop, for the record. Why are we bringing people over here to live in the most deplorable living conditions in our community? Like she just brought up, I wasn't even thinking about that until she came up and said it. But yeah, these conditions really are deplorable. I mean, have you ever been out and walked through there? That's not acceptable living conditions. I got to thinking, though, how come I always come here and hardly ever see any young people come in and address their city council? And I realized it's because you guys really don't care. I mean, whatever we say to you, we hardly ever get any kind of a positive reaction. But there has been a lot of, in the media, people saying that this group, I assume they mean us, coming over here and talking to you guys every week is discouraging people from moving to Twin Falls. Good. I wish somebody had done this for me. I wish I hadn't moved to Twin Falls. I can't find a place to live here to rent within my budget. because all the Section 8 housing is taken up by people that are being brought in from other countries. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Stroop. Anyone else while we're on the public input portion of the agenda? Seeing no one, we will move on with the balance of our business. Don Hall.
Travis, I was just wondering if you could get with Ms. Stroop, and find out what apartment complex she's talking about. Maybe we could have some of our city inspectors go out and ensure that there's no health or life safety issues in that location.
We can do that.
Thank you.
Good idea.
So we handled the consent calendar earlier, so we'll move to our items for consideration, the first of which is a request to review and approve term options for the PSI contract for a 10-year period, and we have Bill Baxter with our finance department. Welcome, Bill. Utility Services, I should say.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. I hope this evening's presentation will be enlightening. I know Mr. Renfro here from Western Waste had requested current bid standards and specs. We aren't currently in a bid process, and so we don't really have any of those developed other than the previous bid that was sent out, I think, in 2010, I believe, was the last bidding that actually took place for this contract. The purpose of tonight's presentation is to review the options that Jeff Brewster, Les Reitz, Nicole, the new CFO here, Lori Race, Travis, and I have reviewed. We also have Sean Stanley here tonight to address the issue of unlimited, which continues to be a point that we don't want to ignore given the quality of life we hope to maintain in Twin Falls. First item, we are looking at a 10-year term. This will provide the incentive to make the investments in the community that they have made. It also, as we get further down here in options that we'd like to explore, encourages them to make the capital investment to adjust cart sizes as we may be able to attempt to do. I know that's been a point that we wanted to try to reinforce and to cover in the contract, especially with a term of this length. So that will cover that point. Again, item number two, it gives us the time sufficient to develop a smaller cart user option, being able to test it and develop realistic logistics for things like how are we going to adjust our billing, perhaps monthly, for challenges to the smaller cart use. We have some ideas, but we don't want to just run out there and try to put this in place and then get run over with the logistical problems. So a pilot program is one of the things we would like to have written into the contract to get that started and see if we can't make that work well. Gives us time to improve an ongoing struggle with the acceptance and use of recycling as opposed to using it as the extra garbage cart and resulting in letters to the editor, because those things simply are lack of understanding or misperception of what can be in those carts when the recycle truck actually picks it up. We hope that this will provide better management of the financial considerations in controlling and establishing incentives for cost of services to the citizen, one thing that will drive the increased use of recycling and the limitations to the smaller cart options if we should be able to offer them is got to be an economic incentive. Sean and his crew do a great job. Les is out there on calls his drivers send in, but economics is going to be the way that we hope to help steer people's acceptance and understanding of how the system would work. Cart size options. Working with PSI, they believe we can offer 35 and or 65 gallon carts as well as the 95 gallon carts for garbage collection. The current year is too short a time frame for effective planning and management, another reason for the 10-year contract. The supplier, for one, is 2 to 4 months out, depending on the demands on delivery of new carts. And once those carts arrive here, then they have to be distributed to interested residents. You may or may not have heard some complaints from people trying to get their 95-gallon carts replaced or new ones at new homes. That was part of the backlog at the supplier, and then once the carts arrived, there was more demand than carts available. So PSI has been ordering and trying to get those in here and get them delivered as quickly as we can. And I have not had any of those calls in a while, so I believe we kind of have filled that gap now. If we proceed too quickly, and this is maybe my pessimism, you offer a cheaper price for a service, and people are going to jump on it. Well, the issue is, you go to a 65 or a 35-gallon cart, you can't have any extras. Can't be anything extra, not a bag of grass clippings, nothing. Again, the economic incentive, we have to make sure it's clearly understood and that we approach each person interested with a realistic expectation that this is what you can put in there. PSI also will have some records as to what those residents are tending to deliver as far as trash. So we won't just be running out there trying to fill this need with cheaper carts only to find out that we've shot ourselves in the foot. Pressure from that same position is going to result in increased demand on the code enforcement team. Again, they're out on any number of lot cleanups and property cleanups, and Les and Sean work very closely together on loads that are either the wrong kinds of things for PSI to pick up, stumps, concrete, those kind of things, or excessive loads on the driver at the stop, and so they work with the property owner to spread that out over a week or two. We want to maintain that ability, but we don't want those people getting a smaller cart and then trying to do that thing. We'd like to, as part of the economic incentives, charge for extra lifts. Now, there would be a standard. Right now we propose, I think it's written in here, 5 bags or 5 35-gallon trash cans in addition to your blue cart. Now, if that is regular weekly, we'll get into an extra lift charge, which at $2.75 is 75 cents more than a monthly rental on a cart. Again, PSI's pricing in order to try to incentivize, if you're going to have a lot of trash, we need you to order an extra cart. Makes it more efficient for the driver, safer for the driver, and cleaner for the residents in the neighborhood. And it takes care of what is going to be a regular load at that address. We also feel like the reaction to the smaller carts, if it went overboard, would start to distract from your time, staff's time, code enforcement's time, and PSI's time in trying to deal with this. So we want to develop a way to offer the option, but also control those people who are getting them to make sure they really don't have excessive demand. Service options considered. Again, each 95-gallon garbage cart service address would be allowed up to the 5 extra large trash bags or a similar quantity of 35-gallon trash cans. That's just to get away from what is unlimited, but also allow them some extras if they have a week where, in my case, I end up with extra bags in May if it rains and I mow my lawn for the first 2 or 3 times after fertilizing it. That's not a good combination. I'm going to slow that fertilizer process down. Each account would have a 95-gallon recycle cart. Now, that is all accounts. 35-gallon, 65-gallon accounts would get the recycle can as well in an effort to encourage recycling. If, however, we run into a contaminated recycle, which does happen, there would be a penalty charged each time. No warning. Would be $5 charge added to the bill for putting trash in the recycle cart. There's been a lot of education on how that works, and that will continue, but there are people who regularly get done with their 95-gallon blue cart, and the first thing that happens is back goes the orange lid and in goes the junk. Now, what that does is it causes the garbage truck driver to have to swing back around because they don't even look in those on recycle day. The recycle driver is the one that spots that, unless it's hanging out the top. And then the recycle driver calls into the office, they radio the trash truck driver, and he has to swing back around. Other communities, if you're late or they have to make an extra trip back around for any other reason other than some kind of a service problem that the provider created, is an extra charge. Extra lift fee, as I mentioned, for excessive garbage consistently put out. This would not be a 1 week, you have five extra bags or five extra cans. But if you do that 2, 3, 4 weeks in a row and it gets to be consistent, that charge, again, economic incentive would come in.
Bill Dunhall has that question.
Yes, sir.
I don't know if you can answer this or someone from PSI, but how do they know that it's contaminated? I mean, because the lid's closed. I don't assume that you open every one and look inside. I mean, you have a route to go. It's just, I'm curious more than anything.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and council members. I'm Jeff Brewster, manager of PSI, and yes, I mean, we wouldn't see it if the lid is closed and the truck picks it up and dumps it. However, in a lot of cases, they can see it poking out the top, and those are the ones. And really, the abuse is like tree limbs, stuff like that is very easy to see. So in a lot of cases, we can see that before we do empty it.
And are these the cases many times? Because I've heard, you know, the urban legend is that you use the same vehicle to do recycling as you do the regular garbage. Is that potentially what's happening? It's contaminated?
Every case, that's what's going on.
Thank you.
Good point.
So nice to have the PSI folks back here. You know, I feel like, and Sean and Lori, I feel backed up. We like to think we've considered this well, but certainly the reason to be here is to get those questions, make sure we have addressed things thoroughly. An extra 95-gallon cart, $2. Extra recycle cart, 90 cents. So we have some people in the community who want to reduce their blue cart because they don't fill it, but they want a second recycle cart. So this, again, incentivizes the recycling side of things.
Bill, Suzanne Hawkins has a question.
Yes.
That's a per month charge, I'm assuming?
That is a per month
charge. Okay. Just wanted to make sure.
Right. Thank you. There would be no extras with the 35-gallon or 65-gallon cart customers. Part of the incentive to have the smaller cart is you don't need to have anything outside of it. The 95, you might as well keep it just because that, if you're going to use it 2-3 times a month, even though there's one week when you don't need it, it's better to have it and utilize it for your maximum loads if they are a regular occurrence.
Greg Lanting.
Yes, sir.
Bill, was it considered to have experience with other communities? I used to own a home in the Phoenix area,
yeah.
And they only picked up what was could be in the can closed. Mm-hmm. I mean, if it was sticking out, the can was up, they wouldn't, they wouldn't pick it up that week. You had to be inside the can and closed, or they just wouldn't pick it up. Anything on the ground wasn't picked up. Also, I live in a condo, and we allow condos to cut their own deal with. And my particular condo has a deal with PSI, and if we don't, they at least let the lids to be up. But our stuff isn't in the can; they don't pick it up. And do we consider that as an option? That just citywide, you have to have it in the can? Because I have a feeling that a lot of the people that are considering thinking that they would like a smaller can, well, they're thinking, well, that doesn't count. My grass clippings, I'll still have those out here in a bag and things along that line. Because I've been very intimately involved with my father since my mother's passing, and I'm having to take care of him more, so I'm over there a lot. He's one person, and he could not make it on a 65 can. His 95 can is virtually full every week, as well as his recycling has. And that's just one person, but he goes through more garbage than some people do. I don't know. But, of course, maybe that part of that's we've been kind of cleaning up the house a little as we're going here, too. So.
Sure.
But, I don't know, did we consider at all that it had to be in a can or there was an extra charge?
Well, I'll tell you, it's interesting you mention that because a number of the cities, I put a few cities that I investigated. Boise will not pick anything outside the can. I don't believe Moscow or Coeur d'Alene will either. Some of them have an unlimited service that is kind of like ours if you do it only every once in a while, and it's not overly excessive, they'll take it. But there are cities here in Idaho that say, no, whatever fits in the can, if you can't fit it in your can, you get an extra can.
Probably does incentivize the recycling quite a bit to have that.
It does have that. And the other person I would call on would be Sean Standley. It immediately crashes into what is our unlimited experience. And just because we're on that topic right now, it might be a good idea to
Yes, thank you, Mayor and City Council. The term unlimited in code enforcement is very nice. It makes our jobs a lot easier. But it's not realistic. So I think in order to keep our city clean and safe, we need to provide as many options as possible. Not everybody's going to put all their garbage in that can. It's just not going to happen. So I think the quality of life will go downhill if we go that route. And I really think that, you know, we're already, between PSI and code enforcement, we're already doing the 95-gallon plus five bags. If it's unrealistic, somebody sets out, let's say, church pews or something like that, then PSI will give us a call and we'll go educate the citizen and take care of it that way. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Mr. Rothweiler.
So part of the challenge in looking at the different garbage cans is really taking a look and reshaping how we do solid waste collection. And we have, as a community, had a history of unlimited trash collection. If you could haul it to the curb and it can physically fit into the truck, we took it away. And so we recognize that if we're going to slowly migrate to a different direction, we think that it probably needs to be done incrementally just to kind of see what that looks like. And I think that's what this first step is. It allows us to kind of control the amount of garbage that is going to the curb without having additional cans. And so we often have talked and heard from the council, it's important for individuals who contribute more volume to pay more load. And so we've tried to build a model that helps with that, but also one that doesn't completely take away some of the best tools that Sean has when it comes to code enforcement of weeds and other nuisances on properties to help ensure that neighborly properties are always well maintained.
Okay, and the next point, just again, develop and implement a plan to increase the availability of the smaller cart use for users that simply don't need it. In addition to the regular weekly pickup, we propose adding into the contract a spring, fall, and Christmas week extra trash collection week, which is not subject to cart size or the ordinary limitation of five bags or cans. So we open that door at the times of the year when people are tending to generate the clean up the yard after winter, all the stuff that you see on the curb after Christmas Day, and then again in the fall when people are cleaning out their gardens. an attempt to address what PSI's experience, and I think mostly anybody else who's kind of driven around during those times of the year sees that. The challenge, I know Travis had asked about this, is, well, you pick a week, and somebody's going to be on vacation, out of town, they're going to forget. We will do our best to promote and advertise that, working with Josh and on the city website. PSI, I know, as part of this contract, again, stressing education on recycling and trash use, trash schedules. We have a recycling calendar. I don't know how many of you have actually seen that. PSI provides it. It tells you what week you are so that on your regular trash day, it's like, oh, this is my weekend. I should have one because I keep forgetting, but I never take one home. But they are great, and on that, we can highlight that week for those services. An attempt to direct people's extra heavy loads from these seasonal things to the curb on that trash day. Additional contract items. We would like to work the unlimited, large and bulky item collection on a per-call basis to the city code enforcement or PSI's office staff. That will then direct the effort to addresses that require that kind of service. Optionally, we could provide a discovery of needed collection or need by or for code enforcement and property cleanup arrangements as is currently done. Sean and his crew, when they see something, or Les, when he sees something, he'll contact us and say, is that an address we should be working on? And then Sean works very well with PSI in getting those properties cleaned up. Let's see. Spring, fall, extra bag, can allowance. Revenue and cost-sharing provision to manage the currently approximately $50 per ton expense to PSI of managing the handling, transportation, and storage of the recycling product. The new contract will retain the current agreement for this first year, where PSI is bearing that cost. It works out to roughly $8,000 a month that they pay, given the market conditions for recycled products. In the future, as we move forward, we would take a look at this. This item is fluctuating based on market conditions. Jeff at PSI says he expects the market to improve over time. We're just not sure how quickly. And to retain the recycling program, it would be one of those items that we need to address in the future. Educational materials and presentations to schools, public service groups, and the public in conjunction with the City of Twin Falls Code Enforcement and Utility Services staff, as well as the Public Information Officer from the City Manager's Office, is currently provided for in the existing contract and would stay in place. Another thing is we want to provide for any expanding opportunities for recycled products and green waste options as those become available. Southern Idaho Solid Waste had taken a look at adopting some kind of a green waste recycling program. Costs of that program and the regulations to make it work were cost prohibitive compared to the just throw it away. That's kind of where we hit with the recycling product, and we're into that and wanting to stay there. But green waste, currently there is no facility to which that could be delivered for the correct kind of processing. So we will write that in as an option for future when there is a way to deal with that product. In conclusion, the proposed PSI contract items support several areas of the strategic plan, which is always an item that when we come forward with budget issues and contracts, we want to address. Number one is a healthy community. Number two is an environmental community. That's initiative EC 1.3, enhance the property maintenance levels in the community. A responsible community. That's initiative RC 1.1A, community engagement program that expands community outreach to all segments of the community. And RC 1.2, the city will support citizen responsibility. In order to maintain the community as it has been, citizen responsibility is key. That's the only thing that makes these things work. And so that is a critical part of what this contract hopes to drive with the education piece and the CART options. The evaluation of the options has reinforced the determination that the small CART price differential has placed those users in the positioning of actually being subsidized by the larger CART users to the tune of about $1.47 per account. Now that's the smaller carts. It's about a penny more for the 95-gallon cart users given the number, which is around 14,420. The options provided in this proposal work toward a smaller size availability, which will continue to push the testing and expansion of the provision of smaller cart services in the futures. One thing I wanted to do, and I skipped right past it. The chart I handed you is going to revisit something Lori Race talked about. I believe it was in a meeting in September 2014 about the pricing of the services from PSI. We enter a contract given a house count and service count in September of the year the contract is being renewed or the pricing is being updated. That house count stays the same for the entire year for PSI, regardless of growth or move-outs from the tenants. We pay for a certain number of residences who are receiving certain types of services. If we have 14,421, our current house count number of 95-gallon cart users, the top part of the chart, then they're paying $10.22 under the current rate. That coincides with zero 65-gallon cart users, the second chart down, and 28 35-gallon cart users. If we move 100 customers to the 65 and the 35-gallon cart sizes. $5 would be the proposed price under PSI's current proposal. If, however, we exceed a 7% shift in any smaller cart size, then, like the third column, 12,403 individuals retain their 95-gallon cart size. Their price goes to $10.74. But to keep the pricing allocated, the 65-gallon becomes $8.52, and the 35-gallon cart size rises to $5.52. Now, again, these prices include the 95-gallon recycle cart, which is not currently something that we have. The chart follows across, but as you reach the far right-hand side, if you have everybody, the current full customer count of 14,449, jump to a 65-gallon cart and nobody's using any other size, they're going to fall back to the $10.22 that is currently the proposed price. You have to cover the contract amount that the city pays every month, no matter what size carts people are using. The trick to the pilot program is to launch these other cart sizes and then balance who has them so that we can provide the right level of service to those customers who need it and retain the more expensive service with those people who don't. However, unless you hold the price even for all the 95-gallon users, which can push it toward $13 as you move across the table to the right-hand side, if you hold $8 as the 65-gallon price and $5 as the 35-gallon price, then you have probably a political issue. I wouldn't know. I know we'll hear about it. But it's the reality of what it costs PSI to drive that truck down the street. And when they stop and they pick up the cart, it doesn't matter to the driver or the truck. They cost the same. It's the cost of the cart being amortized over roughly 5 years that varies. The landfill pricing, and I need to mention this because it also is part of the package. Right now, 35-gallon cart users pay $1.29 a month for the landfill. It's $3.75 for a 95-gallon cart user. So there has been an effort made to reduce the landfill charge for the reduced amount of trash in the 35-gallon cart. The services provided to the city and those delivered free of charge for community organizations and events demonstrates PSI's interest in being a good partner and community member. The letter, I think, that is enclosed in your packet included some of the recap of those items when Kevin provided that. The 10-year time frame of the contract provides for the support of PSI's capital investments in managing the increased cost for the recycling programs and the upgrades of equipment and carts to meet the changing demands of the expanded programs. We really would like to get all residents recycling it. Again, attacking the landfill fees is a tough one, but if we can move more of the stuff away from the landfill will last us longer. I think that benefits everybody. And then this final paragraph, the city of Twin Falls is one of only a few cities in Idaho that provide an unlimited collection, and one of only a handful of cities that provide a recycling program. There are lots of community centers. You can drop off your stuff. You can bring your green waste here. You can do this. But as far as the curbside mingled recycling, we are one of the few. We'd like to keep that going, but certainly I would stand for any questions. Have the PSI crew back here, so I'm sure they're ready.
Thank you, Bill. Chris Talkington.
Well, first of all, I like that term environmental community that you used that might describe our goal, that shining city on the hill that we're all looking toward. May not get there. I originally have opposed a 10-year contract. I realize the capital-intensive nature of waste collection with PSI makes it unique. And I think that there's been a significant effort to turn our waste stream around from the days of unlimited, what's the opposite of consumption, disconsumption, or piling on the public's back. I have extreme difficulty of saying that that little old lady with the 35-gallon trash can is being subsidized by a person with a 95-gallon and five barrels. That's 2 months' worth of that little lady's garbage. You cannot convince me that she is being subsidized by that grossly wasteful waste stream. But that's just a philosophical difference. I think we're on the right track. I've looked into the contract language before us tonight. I would suggest that we do look at the contract under services 1A2, where we prohibit the allowance of new customer 35-gallon cans, at least for consideration. Now, I have to say that because we're almost punitive in nature in saying that some little lady with a 35-gallon can that she only fills up once on Christmas when her family visits is somehow going to go sneaking in church pews and old cars, when we're not concerned about the unlimited amount of garbage, which we're going to have to put a cap on sooner or later. It's just wasteful. I think this is a work in progress, and I am certainly supportive of this 10-year contract now, especially if we do consider the need for recycling at city parks in Twin Falls, which we have none of. We have none on Main Street. And the number of times I've been in the various city parks this year, Bill, the amount of waste that is just thrown in the trash cans as opposed to what can be recycled, I think philosophically tells people visiting Twin Falls that we are not a environmental community. I'd like to change that. But again, I see that this potential contract with some changes and at least the studied opportunity for give a break for the smallest, lowest consumers. And my idea early was that put an age cap on it and maybe some income validation, that there are ways to do this. This is a much improved contract over the one we had expire a year ago. So good work to both you and PSI. One final question, if I might. It is from left field. I have people occasionally ask me, how does the city know that that recycling that has no inherent value, no commercial exchange value, isn't taken out to a landfill in Bellevue or in the Nevada desert and dumped? Is there any way we can and should be able to see verification that our recycling might be transported to whatever your destination is? Is that an unfair question?
No, that is not.
It wouldn't matter because that's still the questions we get.
No, actually, we actually take all of our recycling volume to a third-party recycler here, Magic Valley Recycling. They actually are affiliated with the Boise Recycling Company that does the sorting there. So, yeah, we have weight tickets for all of our loads of recycle volume we take through them. So, yes.
If the city were asked to prove that that waste stream is somewhere, could you do that?
Absolutely.
Down to my 35-gallon trash cans? No.
It would be hard to distinguish how much your how much your 35-gallon volume is in our truck. But, yeah, we can figure
Thank
it out.
Thank you.
Nikki Boyd.
Well, you're still up here. So I've been paying a lot of attention and watching the truck. So I have witnessed a couple things that I was really surprised by or was glad I saw. So when we put cardboard in our orange lid container, that all has to be cut up or crushed so that it fits in there and that it dumps easy. That dump, it rides up a ladder and then it goes in.
Yes.
So when you buy something really big and the box is way too much of an effort for me to cut up, or my neighbor, we sort of flatten it and we put it out next to the can with the orange lid.
Yes.
Okay, so in innocence, well, I'm watching my neighbor's trash be picked up, and the young man gets out of the truck. He's got a box cutter, and he starts slicing this ginormous box into fifths, and it's pretty heavy duty. So he's dumped the can, he's gotten out, he sliced all this up, he puts it in the can, and then runs the can back up the rake. And I am absolutely convinced that everybody thinks that one box on the curb is picked up and hucked in a truck. And it's not. And I think that's that was a real eye-opener for me, how much time it took for him to do his route, because he had to stop and handle. And it was one clean, it was just a big box. It was only this deep, but it was like 18 feet long or something. Yeah. So, not really, but that was it. That was a long time. And so I'm just thinking, again, how do we educate people on that? So that's really, do all the recycling trucks go, it has to be in the can, and the can has to go up the ladder?
Correct. The two trucks we use for recycling are automated side loaders, which actually dumps it up and over the top of the side of the truck, where our other trucks, it's very easy, low to the ground. They can reload the trash very quickly in those. So, yeah, we do have two different trucks operating for this contract and for the two different materials. So, but yes, we'll try and take all of your recycling, and sometimes reloading those cans three or four times to get them all in. We just are thankful that everybody doesn't buy a couch or a large screen TV every single week. So,
mm-hmm. I can only imagine. Then the other question I have with that is on some a can that's tainted. So the lid's down, you can't see it, but it's full of, I don't know, grass clippings, and it gets dumped in that truck. Now everything is contaminated.
Yes and no. Not necessarily is it all contaminated, but it does have to be hand-sorted once it gets to the recycling facility.
Here in Twin Falls,
they would just bale it unless it's easy to pull out here, and then once it gets to the sort line, it is manually pulled out of that recycling stream. So that's what drives the cost up as well. Right now, like Bill said, we're paying $50 per ton for recycling material. Obviously, I would guess about $5 to $7 per ton of that is just to pull out contamination. So, obviously, the less contamination, the further we can drive that cost down.
So we're still paying to have it looked at here, to have it bundled, to have it transported to Boise, and then once it's in Boise, if and when it's contaminated, we're paying again to have it sorted.
Correct.
Okay,
in some
you.
Cases. Where it's good to keep it contamination-free, but yes.
Okay, thank you.
And I would agree, certainly good to keep it contamination-free, but also the market drives that a lot, too, that if they aren't getting paid for the finished product material at a higher cost, you know, that's a cost consideration as well. Go ahead, Bill.
Just a couple comments. Actually, PSI is paying that right now. We are not cost-sharing that, and the proposal would be to study and approach council, certainly, before we did anything like that. But they've been carrying that burden for some time now with the market down, and so we would like to have terminology in the contract to revisit that each year. They have agreed that for this year, they will not only hold the price on the 95-gallon cart service with the recycle can at the 1022, but or at 1037, I believe, is the proposal coming, and also continue to pay that storage handling fee each month on their own.
That was the $8,000
that
you mentioned earlier.
Right.
That's per month,
right.
Okay.
Couple of other items. Ketchum actually contracts, they authorize franchisees to apply for a license, and the franchise license is a 10-year license for Ketchum. They have unlimited, or non-exclusive, I should say, franchisees. So they will contract with anyone who wants to manage trash for the city, and then a resident is obligated to contract with one of those franchisees. But the franchise contracts go for 10 years. And Chris, I agree, the recycling, they have a cart at Clyde Thompson Park up by the restrooms. It's amazing, because I walked my dog there, what you see stuffed in the hole that's supposed to control contamination, and it is also amazing what kind of recycling items you find in the trash cans. And I saw a couple of them burned flat to the ground Sunday morning when I took my dog over there. It was pretty amazing. But we're trying, and that experimental program as part of this at the parks is intended to be
expanded. In the one park?
Actually, they have several test sites. I'm not sure where they all are, but there are three or four parks.
Okay.
When we started the test program for the parks, we went with Harry Berry, Thompson, Candy Cane, or
Cascade.
Cascade, and I believe, don't think of Blue Lakes Rotary, but there was one other park. We had four or five parks that we picked out, trying to stay away from the heavy users to get our hands around it, like Harmon Park, Frontier Field, where they're the heavy use. But we have seen each of those locations has been the lids pried up, waste put in. We've got a lock bar system on it. We've replaced those and patched them because they're just, and there's a garbage can sitting right beside it. So we're trying to work that, but there has been a contamination issue.
Wow.
Thank you, Les. Don Hall.
Jeff, could you come back up? Could you, I don't know if it's common or maybe you could give us an indication. What are we seeing with recycling? Every 2 weeks isn't enough for the Hall clan. We have a lot of recycling. We're probably your worst customers because we have it outside the can a lot.
Well, you're our best customer, so okay. We do a lot. Obviously, you want to make that landfill last as long as possible because we all know that while it will go up in price every year, when they do have cost increase, nothing's more expensive than starting a new cell because they ran out of space. So you want to see landfills fees go through the roof, let them fill up and have to open up more ground. So, we do want more recycling. That's why we encouraged a lower price on this for recycling, being 90 cents a month. So people basically are just paying for the cart, and they can have as many recycled carts as they'd like.
Okay. I was just thinking, I mean, is it more cost effective to do it that way, or pick up every week instead of every 2 weeks? How's that all work out?
Yeah, obviously the cost is mainly in the truck driving down the street and picking up the container. So if you double that, obviously, then you'd have to reevaluate the price at that time. But as far as the container and the extra lift while we're there is not very great.
Okay, so 90 cents for another recycling cart a month. Yep. That sounds like the way to go.
Yep,
thank you.
It is.
That's what we do.
So, Bill, as I was reading through the sort of the memo that went along with this, I was having a little bit of a hard time
deciphering
between options and what's being proposed. So,
basically,
is there sort of a proposal that you all would like to go forward and draft?
We would like to draft a proposal that would include the three cart size option with recycling at each address, and continue to strive for the managing the unlimited, but not eliminate that term, so that we don't get ourselves in a bind. And then the 10-year term. And I think the options recommendations, item 3H, kind of covers the way we would like to approach developing a pilot program and starting in on how that smaller can size might work. Certainly coming back to update council on progress and issues like with the recycling in the parks. And also write in things like allowing for changes in service options. If all of a sudden we got a glass recycler and could figure out a way to collect that, I know we get that question a lot still. The green waste, we want to hold that out there. I believe Southern Idaho Solid Waste has not tucked that away and said forget it, but I think what they're waiting for is a viable option so that the cost doesn't mean they'll invest in a facility and then it'll sit there because everybody wants to throw it in the 95-gallon cart. Those facilities can be quite expensive to meet the requirements of the EPA and the DEQ. Big air tables that blow air through or suck air down through to burn up the various bacteria and chemicals and things that are in it so that it can actually be used for something rather than just thrown in a heap.
Well, I would generally say I'm certainly support. I mean, you've obviously talked about a lot of different issues that we've brought up. I worry a bit that it is complicated. It's more complicated than it is now. But I understand the rationale behind that. I think heading down a road of offering alternatives in the size of the bin is a good idea, but I think we all need to be very aware that that has a cost consequence, because that the big number, we have to get to the big number somehow, and that's got to get spread around all the users. The only specific comment I would make is the contaminated recycling. I understand the so it's sort of the stick and the carrot. So we've got the stick in here of we're going to just give you three chances and then you're out. And I think if our goal is to get more people to recycle, not having an education component at some point in there, I struggled with a little bit, because there's going to have to be a lot of education anyways with all of these new, if you want an extra can or if you're going to do this or do that. So I would encourage us maybe to at least have
a warning period with
a warning of, hey, just a reminder. I mean, maybe specifically saying, you know, you didn't dump the pizza out of your pizza box. That's what the problem is.
Sure.
Not all of a sudden you can't recycle. That was just, I found that a little concerning.
No, and that's a good point. That really came from the times when Les and Sean have been to a location.
Yeah. No, I think if it's the person who fills up their garbage can and then decides to use their recycling bin as a garbage can, right. I don't have a problem with that. Yeah. But the person who, oops, I had stuff in there that I wasn't supposed to. Yeah.
Well, I've talked to a lady who worked at one of our larger local institutions in a position that required some education, and she was sending her kids out. She couldn't figure out why her garbage hadn't been picked up. And so upon further contact with Les and calling the lady back, it appears that the kids must have chosen the recycling cart as the location for the garbage they were hauling out to the alley. So you're right. She was shocked that there were two carts out there and that the orange one wasn't supposed to be used for garbage. So that is a good point. We need to proceed with an education. And then once the education has been documented, then we can start down the path.
Yeah. I appreciate
good.
That.
Nope, happy to do that. The proposal actually was to use these additional contract items and the service options recommendations to work with Fritz and get a draft and send it to you for comment, certainly before we just show up and say, here it is. But we wanted to make sure you understood the level to which PSI is interested in increasing the service level. And we all are interested in improving the citizens' perception of that service as well as the options available so that it meets people's needs better.
Thank you. Chris Talkington.
I'd like to kind of get the ball going on the specifics of this by suggesting that council that per the discussion to discuss authorization of items allowing development of the 10-year contract with PSI by making a motion that the contract under services, primary services, I think one can services, that's 1A2, that says no new customers in 35-gallon cans be changed to allow new customers for the 35-gallon receptacle.
I would just interject that I believe that paragraph would be replaced by the optional cart sizes.
Yeah, so I think what Bill's saying is the information that was in this kind of bullet-pointed Roman numeral document that was attached with our report be incorporated into a contract, and that we have a draft contract come back to us to then go through the detail.
And that is one of the details I was trying to clear up one way or the other. Yep.
We would want to start a pilot program before we try to expand that number, but certainly the user groups that you have indicated, elderly people living on their own who don't generate much, but it needs to reach different groups of people as well. So this would be a citywide, if you really only need a 35.
And I'm not specifying who qualifies for that. I'm just to say to allow it, which it does not now.
No, the contract would be completely modified to open that up.
All right, so you're making a motion to change the wording of that paragraph.
Yes.
Well, for instance, should I just drop it then? I'll withdraw that motion.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, Mr. Rothrock.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, so up here is kind of a illustration of the maybe preferred possible direction to go on that contract. And if this generally looks like something that's favorable to the council, what we will do is we will bring this back. We will modify the existing contract, and that would be the opportunity for you then to be able to modify and edit that and make those amendments. Once the council has adopted the 10-year agreement, the next step would be to go through a public hearing process on the rates, because you'll notice that because some of those rates exceed that 5% threshold and there are new rates to be imposed, we would go through a public hearing process on those rates. Once those rates have been adopted, then we'd be able to move forward and implement the pilot program and implement the contract as Bill had suggested.
Is everyone good with that?
Mm-hmm.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Do you need some kind of a motion to get you down the road, or are you good with the feedback you've gotten tonight?
Good.
Okay.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
That was simple.
So,
well, relatively. Could have been a whole lot worse if I'd have kept talking.
So I do know that Mr. Renfro had signed up wanting to provide some input on this, and you're welcome to address us if you'd like. All right.
This is your education.
Okay. Thank you, sir. All right. Hold on. I got too many piles of paper here. All right. Thank you, Bill. And thank you, Jeff and Les and all of your team. Next on the agenda is a request to approve the purchase of a truck to haul sludge from the wastewater treatment plant. And we have our city engineer, Jackie Fields, on the agenda. Instead, we will have Deputy City Manager Mitch Humble.
Be playing the part of Jackie Fields tonight.
Excellent.
I think she intended this to be on next week's agenda, and we accidentally put it ahead of her. So, but I think I know enough about it to walk us through it. So in an effort to get the budget, which we're going to talk about tonight, a little bit more balanced for next year, there was a request in the budget from CH, or from OMI, to buy a sludge truck. And we thought that we also, in looking forward to the close of this fiscal year, we're expecting a large enough savings to where we might could not budget that sludge truck next year and instead buy it with savings in the rate that we expect to receive this year. And so that's generally the request. It's of an amount that we'll have to go bid it, but we wanted to talk to you about it before we go and bid it first, since it's not budgeted. But the idea, again, is to purchase the sledge truck with this year's contract savings rather than budgeting for the truck next year. So if that's clear enough, then great. If not, we'll try to answer your questions.
Any questions from council? Suzanne Hawkins.
I move that we approve the request to buy a truck to haul sludge from the wastewater treatment plant with the,
to go to bid.
To go to bid. Sorry.
Second.
Motion by Suzanne Hawkins, seconded by Nikki Boyd, to go to bid for the potential purchase of a sludge hauling truck. Don Hall.
Just for clarification, does it need to stay with the savings this year? Does that even matter for the motion?
So what we'll do is we'll kind of go through the process, and what happens is if we're not able to utilize the savings before the end of the fiscal year, that would roll into cash reserves. So what we would do is we would continue through that process, and for fiscal year 2017, we would use cash reserves to move that forward, and those cash reserves would be just plugged in on September 30th and pulled out on October 1st. We're looking at about $382,000 of potential savings from this year's contract, and now it's becoming a timing issue. If we can go through the bid process, get that bid spec'd out, which we believe is ready, published, and then to be able to award before the close of this fiscal year.
Do we have any idea what the costs would be?
We anticipate it's about $125,000.
Thank you.
Any further discussion from council? Seeing none, Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Sean Berriger?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Don Hall?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Next is a request to present the bid tabulation for the 2016 sewer jet truck and recommend rejecting all bids and rebid the project. We have John Caton, our Public Works Director.
Good evening. Thank you, Mayor and Council. As the Mayor just stated, I'm here tonight to talk about the sewer jet bid that the Wastewater Collection Department intended to purchase, or still intends to purchase this year. It's a budgeted expenditure and was formally bid in the month of July. The bid was opened July 21st, and as you can see, there were three bids submitted. Utility truck for $208,000 approximately, Dawson for $179,000, and MetroQuip for approximately $170,000. MetroQuip was the apparent low bid, and when we went through the bids, there were irregularities in more than one of the bids, and it put, in my opinion, us in a position that if I award to the low bidder, there could be a potential protest, and if I reject the low bid and go with the second bidder, there'd be a potential protest from either the first or third or anybody. So I spoke to the city attorney, and he's in agreement that we should reject all bids and rebid in order to avoid any lawsuit.
Don Hall.
Give me an idea of what irregular means.
There's more than one. The example here is that the example here is that when you look at the bid specification, it's my opinion that the bid spec probably could have been written a little more clearly. So when we rebid this, we'll try to make it more clear so this doesn't happen again. But as you can see, I'll give you an example. Gross vehicle weight rating 37,000 pounds. And right above that, above all the check marks, it says all specification to be considered minimum. Okay, so if a bidder is reading this spec and they're providing what they perceive to meet that minimum as 37,000, in fact, it exceeds the minimum, it's 40,000 pounds, many bidders would make the assumption that they can mark yes and move on. The problem with that is the paragraph above that, a couple of paragraphs above that, in my opinion, it says a separate explanation for each deviation must be provided in the list of exceptions. That's important because if you check yes here, but I'm not buying that, I don't know what I'm buying. So it may seem trivial, and trust me, I could probably get on either side of this argument, but the risk here I'm trying to avoid is the other bidder seeing this as a major problem and protesting, and then we're in litigation.
So it's on us that we didn't make the specifications clear enough within the bid documents that we sent out.
I wrote the bid spec, and I'll take partial responsibility. It could have been written more clearly. It's a matter of interpretation, too.
Okay. So, just a learning experience we just want to clarify to.
This document has been through the meat grinder, and I swear it's been used for years and years, and you think it's bulletproof, but it's
sure.
not.
Thank you.
Chris Togginton.
I would move that we reject the bids for the sewer jet truck and rebid.
Second.
Motion by Chris Togginton, seconded by Ruth Pierce to reject the bids and rebid the 2016 sewer jet truck project. Is there any further discussion from council? Nikki Boyd.
John, will the same people bid it, or will these people bid it again and maybe some different ones?
You never know. One of the bidders is here. But whenever you reject the bid, you know, you've exposed everybody's bid. Nobody loves a rebid, especially the bidders. So it's hard telling what any of them are going to do. So I hope we get a good competitive bid.
Okay. Thank you.
Greg Lansing.
John, do we have faced the same issue, or maybe this is a question for Fritz, from the apparent low bidder, do we face the same potential lawsuit for the fact that we rejected all of them, or do we always have that option?
You can always reject bids without any legal implication.
Okay.
Always.
Thank you. makes my yes vote feel a little better.
So I know we did have, so I'm assuming the bidder who is here actually signed up to speak this evening. And so I would like to give him the opportunity to speak, if that's all right with the council. So Mr. Mm-hmm. Smith. If you could please state your name and address for the record.
You bet. Good evening, Mayor and City Council. Thank you for the opportunity to come up here and put some input in on this subject. My name is Ray Smith. I'm employed by MetroQuip out of Meridian, Idaho, 1953 East Commercial Street. I am not a resident of the city of Twin Falls, and I do not own property in the city of Twin Falls.
Thank you.
Some for sale.
Some for sale. Perfect. The topic of discussion, and I've spoke to John a couple of times since the bid opening, and there was some questioning of our bid submittal. I've also had the opportunity to speak with Fritz as well. And one thing I want to be very clear about is I'm not arguing that they're not doing their job or that they haven't put a lot of effort into this project. But I would like to go over a couple of details from our perspective, as this is our business, right? We probably respond to, give or take, 50 to 75 bids per year, and our business model is 95 to 96% municipal. So we're very familiar with the process, the bid documents, the response, what the intent is. And John had indicated on the bid documents that there is a statement, and there's a couple of them. One of them being minimum specifications. Our interpretation and what we've learned from other municipalities is the minimum specification is identified to give your staff in those departments the tools that will allow them to do the job that they need to do. John gave the example of the GVW of this chassis to be 37,000 pounds GVW. As a bidder responding to that published bid specification, because the bid specifications are minimum, if our chassis was a rating of 40,000 GVW, we would check, yes, we comply, because the minimum specification is 37,000. Now, if the bid specifications were not specified as minimum, and a bidder responded with a bid of 32,000 pound GVW, by the time they put water and two lunch boxes and an operator in the truck, it could potentially be overweight. I can go down through this document, and I've taken various notes, or I've scratched down various notes of where we exceed, we happen to be low bid, and where we exceed some of these specifications. A prime example is this hose reel specification, 180 degrees rotation. Okay, back at the beginning of the document, that's the minimum. So the operators want to be able to turn that hose reel 90 degrees to the left. They want to be able to turn it 90 degrees to the right. We exceed that minimum specification because our hose reel rotates 210 degrees. So we get just slightly past 90 both directions for various reasons. Some of the water system, the regulators, 0 to 2,000 PSI adjustable. Our particular product is 0 to 3,000 PSI adjustable. So we do meet the minimum specification to achieve 2,000 PSI. We can actually achieve 3,000 PSI. So going down through this document, there are numerous areas where we exceed, and the intent is that we meet the minimum specification. The topic that got brought up, I believe, by one of our competitors is we do not have a high density polyethylene water tank. otherwise plastic, HDPE. Our water tank is stainless steel. Stainless steel is, I'm sorry, let me back up to the specification. I'll read it specifically. Tank constructed of black high-density polyethylene with ultraviolet inhibitors. The plastic is defined as high-density polyethylene, which is more rugged, with the requirement of ultraviolet inhibitors. Why? Because plastic, over time, sitting out in the sun, it deteriorates and it degrades and it breaks down and you have failures. Our tank is stainless steel. Our opinion is that we meet and or exceed that specification. The spec was for plastic. We're offering stainless steel. The specification did not identify steel will not be acceptable or stainless steel will not be acceptable. So there again, our opinion is that we meet that specification. John also indicated a rebid process. I think that John and his staff and Fritz did a very good job of putting together a bid document for a competitive bid landscape. Now we're exposed. Okay, the difference to the city between our piece of equipment and the second lowest bidder piece of equipment is $9,500. On a rebid, does that incentivize that second place or that third place bidder to look at that pricing again and say, wow, we're going to trim some more fat out of that? Our business model, our integrity, if this does go to rebid, will be the exact same price. That's how we do business. Above board, we conduct ourselves in a very professional manner, and I wouldn't raise our price, and I'm not going to lower the price. It just is what it is. So I would ask that the council look at the items of discussion or the items of the topics of some of the examples that I've given. Read the bid documents. And on page 5, there's also another paragraph that enables the city to reject, accept, essentially any errors, items, or group of items to the best interest of the city. And that has usually been the result, or we've seen those results, that particular phrase be used by various municipalities in protests that we've witnessed. It comes down to the end of the day, I'll just use this situation as an example. The city has determined that stainless is equal to or greater than HDPE. That clause is always in the bid documents, and we've seen that exercised when the city is questioned, and we've been involved in one protest in the last 10 years, and that clause or that out or that leverage was used by the particular municipality, and we go about our business and we tried, and they award it to whomever they decide to award it to, and we go on and we conduct business and we try to earn future business. So I would ask that the city council look at the bid documents as they're stated. They're fairly consistent with the 50 to 75 bid documents that we see annually, and award the business to the apparent low bidder. Any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Any questions for Mr. Smith?
Just bring up some for John.
I did not see any. So.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, John, I think there are a couple questions for you now. Greg Lansing.
John, what are other than the tank, were there other irregularities that somebody might protest?
Potentially. If I go through all of them here, they're public, so should I? Really minor ones. That is probably the main one. And to be clear, this equipment is is good. I don't have a problem buying it. I have a problem entering into the contract because I'm just concerned that we would be in a lawsuit. That's my concern. It's not with the equipment. One of the things we specified that we wanted with an HDPE tank, first of all, a competitor may argue that HDPE is better. I'm not going to argue either side of that. I will say that we specified HDPE for a reason. We believe that it was a mistake. We believe that the configuration of an HDPE tank would allow us to get a short enough chassis so that we can get in and out in the alleys and do maintenance. It's ease of operator use. We discovered through this process that they can't configure a stainless tank to meet that wheelbase length. I don't have a wheelbase length specification here. It's a mistake. It's an oversight. It needs to be added in there. The other thing that we saw an advantage to HDPE is wear and tear on our vehicle. It weighs less, and that means brakes, chassis, suspension, everything. But then we got into the thought, okay, well, if the tank weighs less, does the pump weigh more? What's the ultimate weight difference between the two? Is it really valid? And that's where we're in unclear land, and the cork's off the bottle, and I feel like we have a potential claim situation. If we can see through where we can award to the low bid, I'm all for it. It's way under our budgeted price. I think the equipment is good, but I'm concerned with claims.
Suzanne Hawkins?
So, John, correct me if I'm wrong, but you said we've used this bid form before, and you've never had this same cause or concern. What's different this time? I mean, have we been unofficially threatened, or?
What's different this time is it's the flip side of Mr. Smith's argument. It's. This item here says constructive of black high density polyethylene with ultraviolet inhibitors. Yes. What do you think we're buying? I think I'm buying a black tank. And it may seem trivial, and in the end, I actually think both tanks are probably equivalent. If I rewrote this spec, I'd say black or stainless or whatever poly tank is out there. So that's how I'd really, to be frank, that's how I'd rewrite this spec.
Thank you.
Chris Hawkinson.
I guess my concern, if we don't reject the bid and that second item specifies the high black density polyethylene with ultraviolet inhibitor, we're in violation of our own contract. That's going to open up the door for the losing contract bidders. I don't see that we have much choice.
Any other comments? Dunhall.
So are there any other areas that you see potential that you need to kind of clarify before it goes out again? Because what if somebody comes back with something different that's actually better, but you didn't put it in the contract? And how do you know these things? Is trial and error and what's on the market now?
Yeah. Your first question is how would we prevent it in the future? I would make it more clear that deviations absolutely need to be marked. And it's
explained.
To me, it's clear in there that if you deviate, you need to provide more information. It was not clear, okay. And I understand his argument completely, why it was not clear to him. He feels like he's meeting the minimum and exceeding it in every single case. I get that. I won't debate that. The problem is I think the other bidders will, and their perspective of that paragraph may not be the same as him. So I would rewrite that requirement there. And the second part of your question?
I don't know. I lost myself in my own question.
How do you do this? It is difficult. Obviously, this is not. I don't deal with jet trucks. You know, I try to stay current. We work with them during our budget process to demo trucks. We try to see as many as we can. We call other cities to see what they're using. Really, we rely on the industry to keep us current. We get quotes from them and estimates, and that's how we build the spec.
So maybe I can ask Fritz a question regarding the minimums, I guess, or actually awarding the bid for the lowest bidder. Do we have to take the lowest bidder? So let's say, and I don't know yes. what I'm even talking about. The yes. plastic tank is really cool, but the stainless is way better, but it's only a couple $1,000s more, but it's a higher bid. Can we take the stainless instead of the plastic? No.
You have to take the lowest bidder that qualifies.
Okay.
By statute.
Of the minimum requirements that we put in the document.
Okay. So the confusing part here is this little statement in here that says all specifications considered minimum. It throws everything below it into question because if you look through this list, here's one, cab painted white. I got a better color than white. I got red or, you know. It opens it up for argument. That minimum should be attached to minimum gross vehicle weight, 37,000. That's a minimum. And then they either check it or they don't. And the way it normally works is if they can't check it, then they say, we don't meet that, but what we have is better, and here it is. So we don't have an argument about whether they're meeting the spec or not. And right now, we have an argument from number two bidder. That tank, that stainless steel tank, isn't nearly as good as our modern high-density plastic tank. Okay. So we just want to get rid. We know where the problem areas are. We know how to fix it. And we think that's the right way to go. We don't need to have a contest on this bid when we can just rebid it.
Okay. Thank you.
Seeing no other discussion, we do have a motion on the floor by Chris Toggenden, seconded by Ruth Pierce, to reject all the bids and rebid the project. Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Sean Berger.
Yes.
Chris Toggenden.
Yes.
Greg Lanting.
Yes.
Don Hall.
Yes.
Ruth Pierce.
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Yes.
Nikki Boyd.
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Next on the agenda, Mr. Caton, you're back with an update on the backflow program and discussion on potable water irrigation hours.
Okay, thank you. Tonight we have a few people here to help me with this. Let's see, we have Wally Kendrick. He works for the water department. He's our backflow specialist in inventory. He's really built the backflow program, and Justin Ash has been helping him. He's also a water operator. And as you are all well aware, for the past couple, 2 years, we've been really going into an education campaign to educate the residential users that the backflow ordinance will be enforced and is enforced, and teaching them what it really means to the users. So, and this summer has been really the first season that we've taken system-wide approach to enforcement. We sent out thousands of letters and made changes to our program for the better. And really, kudos to these two guys, Wally and Justin. So I'd like them to maybe come up and give a little bit. I know, Justin, you have some numbers, and do you want him to give numbers? Okay. So Justin's got some numbers. I also want to mention that Mike Brown with DEQ is here also. So later on, when we want to talk about DEQ stuff, he's here if you have questions.
John, could I just ask a quick question? Are we talking about a potable irrigation system? In other words, house water, domestic water.
Yes.
It's not the pressurized irrigation system. This
That's
is
right.
all the backflow
I'm glad
on
you,
all
I'm glad you
irrigation.
Asked. A lot of people are confusing because it does happen. Pressurized irrigation absolutely should never, ever be cross-connected to anything. And I know that there's pressurized irrigation out there that gets connected to potable water, and they put a backflow device. And when we see that, when we know about it, we let people not know that they can't do that. So it's completely disallowed to cross-connect PI. What we're talking about is potable water, just like you said.
Welcome, Justin.
Thank you. These are numbers on the letters that we have sent to our residents. Month broke down, the test due, how many have been completed, and what our compliance rate is right now to each month. And then in the bottom part is the actual number of letters that we sent the 3 months, trying to get the letters out to the customers and letting them know about getting them tested.
So just less than half are currently compliant, correct? Is that what I'm reading there?
No, go ahead. Yeah, I mean, yes, in the grand scheme of things right now, we're just less. I think it's about, if you do the very total, I think it's about just over 40%.
One thing I'd like to highlight that Justin didn't is, well, first of all, in January, you can see there's a 93% compliance, and you can see 87, 65, 81, 77, 53, 20, and then it drops because we're in those months right now. I think these are great numbers. I'm impressed with the amount of compliance. It doesn't mean it hasn't come with the outgrowing pains. June 1st, when we sent out 2,428 out, we were bombarded with phone calls and confusion, even in spite of the education piece. So it was an opportunity for these guys to rethink about the program. One of the couple of things that they implemented that I think is great, first of all, there's a frequently asked questions brochure that's on our website. And also on each letter going forward, there's a hotline that that these guys developed. Basically goes through all these we were getting literally hundreds of phone calls with the same questions. Tells us we have a system problem. So we've created a hotline, answered these questions, and when we sent out the second wave on the 18th and the third, the calls have dropped significantly. I mean, less than 50? Yeah, I mean, they've dropped significantly. They have a backflow program automation that's been working great. Justin's been really helpful with that, along with our IS. They are trying to develop also an online test form so that testers can go out and fill out an online form and submit it to the city. Right now, he's automated it to the point where they can email test him, because before they were hand carrying him in, there's still some testers here that do that. In fact, I apologize. There are some testers in the audience. I recognize some of them, but how many testers are here tonight? Just you? Okay. So as far as availability with testers, do you want to
We've noticed what really has pushed us. You know, you can see that we kind of went mid-July, because June we had so many calls and so many people that they were calling testers and they're like, "We can't get you done. We can't get you done. They're gonna have to put you off." And so, middle of July started turning around, and I got testers talking to us. Hey, when you send in the next batch out, we're not busy. We got no one. You know, no one's on our list. And I said, "Well." You know, and we had about four, so we talked about it, and we decided to send out more letters. And then again in August, just the first August, we did the same thing, because testers were running low on devices to test. So we got the letters out and got them busy again.
Great. Thank you, Justin. Greg Lanting?
So Justin, or John, either one, how do we know, like, I'll give you an example. My father, I don't know if he got a letter or not, but since I'm on council, and I knew he had an old system that needed to be updated, so we contacted his sprinkler person, and they came, and $425 later, they put in an entirely new, they had to change quite a bit, because he had a system from the 50s that obviously was not going to work, okay?
Yeah.
And so they replaced his system, changed it quite a bit. Now it's, you know, so then $425 what it cost me. But we didn't notify the city. Did the person who did the job notify the city? That'd be the question I have.
Right, yeah.
And I can't remember if we got a letter or not, I'll be honest with you.
Yeah,
I just
tester,
knew we needed
the tester knows what they need to do to comply. And so the tester would submit the test report.
I just wanted to make sure that
In fact, I'm glad you said that, though, because I don't know if this is still happening. Sometimes testers either turn them in late or fail to turn them in, and so the customer gets another letter. They're upset. And
I think, now that I think about it, I think we did get a letter, and that's what prompted us to do it. But also, on the second part, you talked about the busy part. Since I live in a condo, so I don't have a lawn, but obviously I have a couple lawns, I think, here. My girlfriend's lawn was having some sprinkler issues. And so she uses the same sprinkler people who fixed my dad's thing, and we couldn't get them for weeks. I mean, and we had a problem. We had a valve that was stuck open and was just running. And so I was having to go out and shut it off every night. Luckily, hers is on a PI system, so at least we weren't wasting potable water, but I'd have to go out and turn it on and off every day, depending on her watering day, I think. So I know they were busy for a while, because you couldn't get them to come out because they were busy doing backflow systems. So, you know, that has caused an issue there. But I'm glad to hear we actually have enough backflow people that they could run out of work at different times. But I brought up the 425 just so we kind of, as a council, we know that for some people, and my dad can afford $225, but I'm not sure everyone in his neighborhood can, to be honest with you. $425 is a pretty big hit to somebody who's on Social Security and that kind of thing, but we have a federal law we have to amend complying to, so thank you.
If I can follow up your question, I thought you were going to ask a little bit different, but it reminded me of something I wanted to share. One of the things that these two guys do that they won't tell you is I sit in the office and I can hear the phone calls come in, and we get the spectrum, right? But we also get the person who really wants to comply and does not understand. I know that both of these guys have stopped what they're doing, tried to explain it on the phone, and if they can't get it clear, they'll actually go out to their house and look and go, yeah, you have this, you need this, or you're good. We even had a scenario where Wally went out, the homeowner was billed for an installation of a backflow device that didn't get installed, and that person was not responding to the customer's calls. Wally went out, and he called the contractor, and they were there like that. So kudos to these guys. They do get out of their office and try to help. It's not easy. There's thousands of customers, and I'm impressed with their ability to get out in the field and help these people that really don't understand.
I would like to say, too, we've seen a lot of phone calls and response from the water bills. We communicated with the finance, and Bill got little messages on the water bills talking about backflow and getting it tested, and it generated a lot of phone calls, too. So, I mean, people are seeing it. You know, if we're not sending them a letter, they're seeing it on their bill, and everybody gets water bills. So,
thank you. Don Hall.
I have several questions, but I'll just start with two so we can spread this around. So I always thought that you had to have a charge system to have the backflow tested. That's not true?
I'm not backflow licensed.
Because I see in January, generally we don't charge our systems in January, and you have some that are due.
Those will be our commercial accounts.
Okay.
Restaurants with soda machines and devices that are inside. Not lawn, those
kind of things. And so,
processing plants.
So they have to be charged to check them.
Correct.
That's why the heavy due dates are in the summer months. Okay, that's why. Because I was just thinking, if that otherwise, why don't you spread it out a little bit? Okay. Number two, the non-compliance. Tell me what happens with people that don't comply now with our system, Wally.
Well, Council and Mr. Mayor, right now we're not really playing hardball with the city. Okay, we've had a lack of testers, which causes huge backlog, where some testers 2 to 3 months out weren't taking new clientele. You know, some people are having a hard time getting one installed. Number one, get them tested. Number two. So that being said, yeah, there was maybe a few that were lacking some work, but there was a ton being slammed. So as of this year, being that it's new, we're, you know, a lot of people aren't aware of what it's for, why we're doing it. You know, it's basically just, you know why we're doing it. But so we're not really playing, we're not shutting anybody off. We haven't, to my knowledge, shut anyone off. Not unless somebody that we know says, we're not going to do it. Simple and pure. And then, in that case, I imagine that that will happen. You know, because if, on the one hand, if you don't play hardball eventually, everybody thinks you're just bluffing. And they're like going to say, I'm not going to shut me off. I'm not going to do it. And so we don't shut anybody off. So this year, like I said, it's kind of a, okay, we're going to ease into it and not make it so painful, you know, not make people have to cough up a ton of money if they don't have to. Maybe next year might be different. But as of this year, we're giving them a lot of latitude as far as that goes. So,
Mr. Mayor, I don't see any of the lights. May I ask one more question?
You may.
The fine gentleman from DEQ. How's that for an intro? So I've had several folks ask me, why do we have to do this every year? Seems like it's pretty expensive to do it every year. Is there that regulation that says it has to be tested every year? Is there any way around that? My questions usually drag on. I'm sorry. Is there any way around that?
No, those annual tests are based upon plumbing code and AWWA standards for backflow that's done through USC, University of Southern California device testing. It's a standard backflow practice. It's done nationwide. Lots of cities are doing it. To iterate on that, it also is in rule that those have to be tested annually, both federal and state.
Okay. And I know we came to the game a little late, if I've been told that
not
correctly.
The only one.
Okay.
I mean, the rule has been around with DEQ since 1997, previous to DEQ being part of the health district. It was in the rules then as well. So it's been around for quite some time. It's been to the legislature just in 2012 when we added that assemblies not passing have 10 days to be replaced. So it's been in front of the legislature quite some time going forward.
Thank you, sir.
And then I would like to say to the city and to the mayor and you guys that your program has been progressing very well, and it is one of the better shining examples out there. There have been a YouTube video out where you've gotten collaboration with some of the other cities locally, and it's been well. We realize that there's a lot of growing pains, and we're there behind you.
Thank you, sir.
Well, I appreciate the I'm happy to hear that it's a shining example. That makes me proud of our crews here at the city. I will say, too, I think that the initiative to be educational about this as much as possible, but to Wally's point, at some point, if you're not enforcing the rule, you're not enforcing the rule. And so I think the opportunity to work with folks and be communicative about the regulations and how to take care of it. I think the partnership, too, with the device testers. I mean, I think this probably was a little overwhelming for them as well. I mean, I know when we're not doing this, it has been difficult to get someone to come fix sprinklers in the summer. It's their busy time. So I appreciate that partnership, too, and I'm hopeful we can get through some of this backlog, and hopefully as we roll into next season, it will be maybe a little smoother. Chris Togginton.
You know, if I had known that I was going to get this letter in July, wouldn't it have been simpler when my sprinkler person came out to activate the system to have it done at that time? Wait a couple minutes till the system is charged and see if the backflow valve is in place. Wouldn't that make more sense to remind people before they activate their sprinkler system in the spring to have it done in one step check? one check.
Yeah, there's a couple. Yeah, so you're saying when you fire up your system for the year, why don't you test it then, is what you're saying, right? And it makes sense because that's when you're going to use it, and that's the most current test and everything. That means we'd be sending out 7,800 letters in 1 month, and we have a real problem getting the testers to be able to do that. So ideally, I would say yes. And, you know, weigh in here if you have a comment, but the rule requires an annual test, and we are meeting the rule, but ideally, I would agree with that statement.
Gone home.
So I don't think anything would prevent you if you have somebody come out and charge your system, a professional, have them check your backflow, then send it in early.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
Since we know that we have to do it annually, actually one of my property, my home, didn't get a letter this year. And so I felt it's probably still wise for us to go ahead and do it again. And so we need to get into this pattern to do it. I've always wanted, because I charge my own system in the spring, and then I have someone come and obviously blow it out. And I wanted to do it then because it would save me some money because it's all in one shot. But that doesn't make any sense because you want to check it while it's charged to make sure it's not leaking into the system. That's the ideal issue here anyway, is that we don't want any contamination into our water system. That's why we have the rule, right? So.
All right. So there's half of John's presentation.
Okay, thank you.
Under item number 4.
I think 2/3.
Actually, I should look here real quick. So we did have somebody signed up, Michael Brown. Okay, that's perfect. That's right. Check that one off the list. Thank you.
Okay. So the second half of the conversation was irrigation hours. And so a while back, I believe the mayor or Councilman Hall received an inquiry from a citizen about potable water irrigation hours, which is after 5 p.m. you can irrigate up until 10 a.m. Why those hours? If we're a conservation concerned city, why those hours? There's actually a pretty simple reason, and actually I had to call Tom Courtney today to ask him what this practical reason was. And it was a fantastic reason. I actually called GEB and got a really good, lots of good information. But Tom's was excellent. And he said, here's the answer. The hottest part of the day, if we want to go strictly to the least hot part of the day, we would go from 12. We would allow irrigation from after 7 p.m. and go till noon, right? We wouldn't hit 5 o'clock. The problem is, or the not problem for people with sprinkler systems, is that's a push of the clock, right? You just change your clock. The people who drag their hose, it takes many people with a sprinkler system 5 hours to irrigate the yard. I mean, it depends on your yard size and how many zones you have, but it can take 3 to 5 hours to irrigate your yard with a sprinkler system. When you're dragging a hose around, it's going to take you at least that, I would say. So the thought behind it was, for the people that don't have sprinkler systems, if they're supposed to drag their hose from 7 till midnight or, 7 in the morning till noon while they're at work, it doesn't work for them. And I thought that was a really practical answer. Now, this is city code. It's council's code. And if you'd like us to look at it, it certainly is not the most efficient as far as evaporation goes. But there's a practical aspect there that we're trying to balance. And I thought that was great background.
Don Hall.
I'm the one that brought this up because the gentleman that sent us this information had a bunch of science behind it. I don't know if you received all that science and the different kind of sprinkler hose. He called himself a hose dragger. Okay, so that's not my turn, but he said hose draggers, the kind of sprinklers they have evaporate far less than typical
sprinkler systems in the ground because of the way that it sprinkles, and the size of the water sprinkles, I guess. And so my question is, can we be a little more flexible with the hose draggers, the folks that have mm-hmm. to drag a hose around on the hours, and then encourage those that use sprinkler systems to do it in the less evaporative time? Because he had some real good points about the reason that we have this whole rule is so that we can conserve water, and if we're using it during the times it's not conserving, we're kind of shooting ourselves in the foot. Travis.
So one of the challenges that I see, and I think it may, the first thing I'd like to say is, if the council wants us to spend a little bit of time looking at some adjustments, and I think that was John's point, we can certainly do that. One of just the immediate concerns that I had is we, when we're doing code enforcement, and Sean and his team are out there looking at sprinklers, who's running, who's not, it's a lot easier to look at a clock to know who is supposed to, you know, when you're supposed to be operating your sprinkler system, as opposed to knowing who has one. So, I mean, if you're dragging a hose and you throw on the hose, right? So, I'm gonna use my sprinkler system until I can no longer use my sprinkler system, and then I'm gonna drag my hose, and I'm gonna put my hose on those dry spots that weren't covered by my sprinkler system. And I only think that because if there's a way to game the system, we'll find a way to do it. And so, if the council is interested in us looking at some alternatives, we can certainly do that, and we can bring those back in preparation for the next irrigation season and do some education. It sounds like tonight, whether it be through garbage and sanitation and recycling, or whether it be through irrigative practices or backflow and when to get that test, it sounds like we have a really good educational opportunity and push. We can build a new system in time for the next, or propose some ideas and suggestions, and then and be in a position to share what that looks like if that's of interest to the council.
Greg Lansing?
Well, I'm going to throw another whole wrinkle in here. One of my golfing friends went specifically to a training, I'm going to say it was at CSI. I don't know where it was. It might have been at a hotel somewhere or a convention thing. I take it back. It was at Canyon Crest, where for a small fee, you could become a better green thumb and have your lawn look better and all these different things. And they were telling them, if you want your lawn to look the best, water during the middle of the day. That was actually their suggestion to them, and he can do that since he has a well. He lives out of the city. But I had never heard that before. I'd always heard that would stress your lawn to water it in the middle of the day and all those different things. So just the wrinkle, and it's probably not appropriate for this conversation, but it kind of tries to throw another wrinkle in our thought process of trying to save water. But if we're making, apparently not his estimation anyway, the person teaching the class, not the best for your lawn to water in the middle of the night, that kind of stuff. So,
Nikki Boyd?
The reason in the real world that I see all the time is when you're on a pressurized irrigation system, you don't always, and you're supposed to, you're an even-numbered house, and so everybody's supposed to water, and we're all of the impression you want to water early in the morning. So some people just don't have enough. If everybody's doing it, there's one or two people who absolutely believe that they do not get the pressure and their fair share of water, so they wait till everybody goes to work, and then they're running their PI system after 10 o'clock in the morning, because they claim that's the only time they can get enough water to really water their grass. So my guess is every neighborhood you go to, they're going to have a theory on how this works and what works for them. I don't know how you ever come up with something that's consistent.
Just to follow up, as far as pressurized irrigation goes, the watering schedule allows for watering all day for PI. In fact, the canal company encourages it. Our shares come 24/7. So they, on your day, odds are evens, depending on your address, that's what you can water all day.
Oh, well, I'll go home and spread the word.
Even in the hottest part.
Actually, let me point out that our stations aren't designed for the entire subdivision to water at the same time. Right. It will fail. In fact, if you're having a pressure problem,
that's probably
go find a different time.
Okay, I've never experienced that, but there's people in my area that I know, but I mean they really, and I'm thinking, you know, enough of them really believe that, but somewhere in their head they have it that it has to be the 10 to 5 is not for them, but on PI that's not a problem. So
it's funny, I know I've experienced that. It's something we remind people pretty regularly.
Thank you.
So John, I'm glad you actually got in touch with Tom and reminded me of that practical reason. So I was actually on the committee that helped to write all these rules when it came to the council initially. Mm-hmm. And that was, I remember we were talking about, you can have all kinds of science that tells you about evapotranspiration of when it's going to evaporate the most. But there was a practical matter of people are awake during the daytime. And that's when they can go drag hoses. And so we had that conversation. Travis, to your point, I think what might be helpful is maybe following this irrigation season, if we could have a report that talked about violations this year, how did the program go? And I think if we can identify a big giant trend of everybody's watering at noon, then let's talk about it. But to be honest with you, if it's one or two people who want to have a debate about whether the water is going to evaporate or not, I don't know that that is worth implementing a wholesale change to the program.
Correct.
Unless we have big violations with it.
To me, it's also a recognition that we know that we're doing it for this practical purpose.
Right. So, Travis?
We can do that. And as I included in my weekly report this week, just really quick, and maybe we're going to kind of share and celebrate this through Josh. You know, we got our peak day water consumption number for this year, and this year's peak day is 24.59 million gallons, which is less than the prior 2 years, and it is a continuing downward trend. In fact, just in 2008, on the graph that I sent, we illustrated that our peak day was 28.5 million gallons, and prior to starting all the conservation, it was at 33.5 million gallons. If you break that out just into per capita water consumption in 2003 was 911 gallons per person. And if you move that to 2016 using a current estimated population, it dropped to 518 gallons. That includes all industrial consumption, all commercial consumption in that mix as well. And so when you think about how industry has really continued to grow and evolve in our community, and to know that our peak day is, you know, nearly 10 million gallons less than what it was in 2003, I think this illustrates that water conservation is working in Twin Falls.
Thank you. John, anything else on that?
No, I don't, unless there's any other questions.
So, John, I know you're next on the agenda, too, but I would like to take about a...
it's the John Show.
About a 10-minute recess. So we will come back at 20 minutes after 7.
You have to go change the sprinklers.
We got to move on.
All right. We are back. We will come back from recess at 7:20 for the council meeting. And Mr. Caton, you are back to talk about a draft sidewalk replacement program and application.
Thank you. Good to be back. So last year we talked about all the sidewalk problems that we're facing, and council and our citizens have expressed an interest in not only trails and walkable pathways, but sidewalks and connection and passable sidewalks. So, you know, we talked about in the budget process the opportunity to take it's a massive problem that we can't fix overnight, and we're going to take a pronged approach to dealing with ADA non-compliant sidewalks. And so before I get into this repair grant application, just want to give you a quick update. We have, to date, we have about 14 special requests from our community for ADA accessibility. And what that means is we budget each year about $50,000 in anticipation that somebody who has a disability and they can't access a public facility, they let us know that they're having an issue, because we know we have ADA issues throughout the city. So what we try to do is prioritize these special requests. We call them special because they're very important and they're a high priority, and we need to respond to them. It's part of our ADA transition plan. We need to respond to these types of requests. So to date, we have, I want to say, I wish I would have brought it with me, we have about 14 different locations that have identified ramps specifically that the public uses and as having difficulty accessing. It's in excess of $86,000 in order to do that. So we don't have the funds to do them all. I've been in contact with two of the people. I was actually in the home of one of the two, and we talked about what the program can and can't do, and tried to explain that we will be addressing the ramps, not all of them this year, but all of them at some point. And next week we're going to be going out to bid. We're going to bid about 10 of these different ramps, about, you know, we're guessing around $50,000. So that is one piece of the solution that's going to take a long time to address in the city. Another piece is our capital line maintenance program that the council has been outstanding in supporting year in and year out for the past, I don't know, 6, 7, 8 years. And as a part of that, streets, water, and sewer all have funds to go and replace, as you know, their infrastructure. And when we do that, if there's a sidewalk nearby, we get that. We scoop that up too. That's the second piece. The third piece is what I wanted to talk to you tonight about, and that is the sidewalk repair grant application. It's one of the programs that we've never had before. I'm excited about it. It's a small piece in this solution, but it's an important one. And tonight I wanted to talk about what I really needed. This is our, meaning council's and staff's, grant application program. So I wanted to present it tonight, make it clear what we thought the intent would be, that council wishes, but obviously let me know if there's something that's not here that you want to add, or if there's something you don't like. That's why I'm here tonight, is to get your feedback. So to begin with, we, you know, rather than reinventing the wheel, we looked at a couple of different cities that had a program in place, and so we found Beaverton, Oregon. Actually, Dean with the Streets Department, he found it online, looked at it, and thought it was really close to a great starting point for us. So that was where this document was born from, and we've made lots of little changes to it, but in spirit it's virtually the same. And the intent of the this is where I need some council feedback. The intent and the spirit of the application, we felt, engineering and public works, was to focus on homeowners, single family homeowners, in areas that have existing sidewalk that don't meet ADA requirements. We made the assumption that we wouldn't target rental properties, apartment complexes, and businesses, because the assumption is that we wanted to be helping people who actually need help. So that may or may not be a flawed assumption, but we try. That's the intent. The spirit is to address single-family homeowners. You have to actually be the homeowner, the property owner, to apply for this grant. Second, we needed to, you know, there's, as we talked in the past, there's a huge cost in designing and constructing stormwater facilities, and stormwater facilities include curb, gutter, and storm drains and pipe. There's a huge cost there, so this program doesn't support that. It supports existing sidewalk, the sidewalk that's lifted by a large tree, or broken up, basically failed and does not meet the ADA requirement. And again, the reason we focus on that is we've got such a big issue to address. We wanted to start with what we already have out there that's not meeting and fix that first. I'd like to go through a little bit of the program. I won't go through every step, but basically I hit on the intent, on the target of who we would like to help. And I want to point out that city code will still require homeowners to be responsible for their sidewalk. This program doesn't put us in any position to be liable if we don't, you know, it doesn't put us in a position of liability. I've had Fritz take a look at this, and this doesn't give us any risk or exposure. What it does do, though, is it helps people that may or may not have, like I said before, sometimes it's a very large tree that is lifting the sidewalk. So you might have one slab that doesn't meet, but that tree costs $800 to remove. And the slab is, what, $100. And so this program would include a tree removal and tree replacement of right-of-way trees. No, so I'm not talking about your tree that's up by your driveway, by your house. This is an actual right-of-way tree that's in the right-of-way. It's a city tree. So if those trees are uplifting the sidewalk, they'd be eligible for funding. The intent would be to have homeowners ask for bids, two bids, and the city would fund the lowest bid or the lowest actual cost up to half of it, up to $1,500 per application. There's also situations where sidewalk doesn't need to be removed and replaced. It might just be some grinding. And that has a different cap, $750, because generally it's costs less. There's a lot to the process in here, and we could go on and on about it, but really, this is all work that's in the right-of-way that requires permit, inspection, and approval of tree removal. So it does require permits. We will continue to have oversight. We'll be able to see the product after, because we're paying for some of this. We have a vested interest in its quality, and we'll have an opportunity to inspect. We also will be in a spot where we will pre-approve applications. So if we have homeowners coming in and they want their sidewalk that's completely passable, but to match the shade of their driveway, obviously that is not going to meet the intent or spirit of this. So we will go through a pre-approval process and go look at these properties. So there's pre-approval. The homeowner will be responsible for soliciting bids. And the funding arrangement I went over. And do you have any questions?
Don Hall.
I think this is a great start. I had a little bit different vision, but this is just my own vision. One of the challenges, and one of the, I guess I'm really passionate about trying to get sidewalks out for folks that maybe that's their only mode of transportation. Folks that have limited mobility, wheelchair bound, you know, some of the other issues that take place. And I know in a significant part of our town, especially the older part of town, there's no sidewalks at all. Or there's a sidewalk for a block and then no sidewalks anywhere else. And I know that that's probably been done through the years where they remodeled their house and they had to put a sidewalk or build a new house, and then nobody else had to. So my vision was not only for the repair, honestly, but it was for the actual installation of new sidewalks to try to start, because we need to link these neighborhoods together, especially when we start talking about public transportation that we're going to have to be looking at here in the very near future. How do people get from their homes to a public transportation place, a bus stop, if there's no sidewalks in between? So I guess that's one of the concerns I have with this. I like the replacement, but I also think that we need to explore at least the option of installation as well. And I'd love the idea of a 50-50. You know, we both have skin in the game. I think that's a great thing. I don't know if we need to put language in here about this, but I would also really encourage us to have some special consideration when we start talking about maybe a whole block can get together and say, we want to do this block because there's no sidewalks on this block, and we all want to go to the city and see if we can get some help with this, and we'll all pony up 50%. Maybe that'll be the thing that sends them over the edge to be able to start linking these neighborhoods. And then I don't know what to say about the rental versus the owner, because it doesn't matter if they're a rental or not. It's still, those people can't get around because there's no sidewalk. So I don't know if we should be as strongly strong of language saying no rental, as long as the owner of that rental steps up and say, I'll do 50%. I don't know why we would discourage that.
I totally appreciate your comment, because I, you know, from my perspective, let's say we don't spend that $50,000, you know, I mean, I think if, you know, there's a good chance that apartments and businesses would jump all over it. Why would I complain about leveraging more and getting more sidewalk in? So on one hand, totally get it. On the other hand, what about the homeowner that does lose their voice? And, you know, really the approval process is first come, first serve. So they would have an equal opportunity to get in there. Maybe it wouldn't be an issue.
I think this is a great start with those other considerations. At least that's how I feel. I don't know how the rest of the council feels.
Chris Talker.
Well, I think we are pretty much on track to make a good start this year, and we can tweak it later. I'm not adamantly opposed to rentals, especially a single-family home. I don't know about apartment. I've been spending quite a bit of time door-to-dooring in the Old Town section, and you know, some of those sidewalks, I would guess, have to be 70, 80 years old, and they're just crumbled into nothingness. At the same time, they're rentals. They're not, a lot of them are not owned. But I think we also, concurrent with this, need to reacquaint people to the LID process, where an entire block can get a, under the city's auspices, I think, a pretty good rate on an entire project being done, and perhaps we could help in some way financially. But I think we need to not get a perfect project. Let's get it going this year, see if we can make a visual impact. I think the word will spread in the ensuing years that this city is working on their behalf, as long as they put some skin in the game, as you say.
Any other comments or suggestions from the council? Suzanne Hawkins.
Just a quick add-on. I don't have a problem with property rentals either, but I do not see opening it up to businesses personally. I think businesses should have their own capital to work with and take care of themselves. Just my two cents.
Greg Lanting?
I'll add on to that same thing that Chris said. I think maybe rentals that are single family, I'm all right with. I'm not sure about apartment houses and fourplexes and that kind of stuff. Somebody typically has, it's an income generating thing for them. And I think for this to start with, I think we need to stay with single family homes. But that's just my thing, and that may cause a legal issue. I'm not sure, but I like the start. I like Chris's idea that, hey, let's get this going, and then we can tweak it and add to it as we see how it works.
Nikki Boyd?
You can't differentiate between a single-family home as a rental in a fourplex or a duplex, particularly when they're set in their infill projects, so it's a whole neighborhood, so you got a bunch of houses, and then you have a nice-looking fourplex in there, and then another house, and so I think if we're going to go with single-family housing, owner-occupied, otherwise we're off in the weeds on that, because I don't know how you differentiate.
We make ourselves clear, John?
I was going to follow up.
It's a start.
Yeah.
I didn't see any other
okay.
lights blinking at me, so do you have any more questions for us?
Great. Okay. I think what I heard for the moment, this is the exact feedback I was hoping for. I heard a little bit of a mixed bag, but how would you like me to proceed? What I heard is that single family rentals are okay. How do we want to proceed, Mayor?
Don Hall?
What I heard the majority of us say is that single family rentals are okay as well, because it's, again, it's this skin in the game. Even if it's a fourplex, I agree with what Nikki said, and I was watching the body language. I think the majority of us said that single family rentals make sense too.
Okay. But the application is going to have to come from the property owner.
It will.
Right. So then that means we would allow somebody with 10 single family homes to apply, potentially, 10 different applications.
And I would give priority to owner-occupied and owned homes over rentals.
So maybe that first in line needs to go, and then we get the applications by a certain date and then have a prioritization.
So I'm going to be honest, the seven of us trying to micromanage how you're going to figure out how to assess this program is going to be, we'll be talking about this a year from now and have not built a sidewalk.
Correct. Thank you.
So I think you got some general direction. If you think it's going to be manageable to figure out how to do owners owned and rentals and fourplexes and all that,
put it
in the procedure.
Thank you.
If it's not going to be manageable, then
come back.
Either come back to us and say this is not going to be manageable and we're not going to get an ounce of concrete poured ever.
Won't be much poured this fall.
I don't think it's that complicated. I think we'll get this going.
Well, we got some good pours.
Part of the idea is that we would have this available in October, but probably likely starting the project in next spring. And what we would be able to do is we'll be able to report during next year's budget process to determine how successful it was, whether or not we've been able to, you know, really allocate the $50,000. Do we, you know, is it too much? Is it too little? And we can kind of really begin to, once we dive into that program, find ways to tweak it and continue just to improve upon that. But I think, like anything, this will be just kind of that really first stab out there to have a sidewalk replacement program.
And it may be helpful to still promote it this fall, that it's available, so that it's not, you know, another thing that's on my list to do in the spring.
Applications. Yep.
Well, we've just doubled it. 50,000 is 100,000. We're chipping away at it, because the other 50 comes from the owner. Yeah. I mean, we're chipping away at older neighborhoods that don't have either sidewalks and or they're crumbling. $100,000 a year. I think that's a great start.
Thank you, Boyd.
Well, and it's people we heard at city fairs, and we've heard people talk about sidewalks for so long, and we're getting something out there as fast as we can. I think that's really great. Thank you for working on this.
Thank you.
It's in the budget.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, Mayor.
Okay.
There's only one more item on the agenda. You can hang around for it if you'd like. Make sure. So the next item on the agenda is presentation of the city manager's recommended budget for fiscal year 2017 for strategic plan focus areas 4. related to accessible community, and 5, environmental community, followed by citizen input, and we have Deputy City Manager Mitchell Humble. Welcome again.
This should be showing you a picture right now. Oh, look at that. You've seen a lot of this before, so I'm going to go fast. There. No, I'm kidding. I'm sorry.
Jim Wood would be so proud of you right now.
Did you get that? Any questions? No? All right. Okay, so again, we're building our budget around our strategic plan. Tonight, I'm going to be focusing on 4 and 5 accessible community, environmental community. That's actually the reason why we had John here doing all of those presentations tonight, so you could talk about water and sprinklers and sidewalks, because that's all coming up in this budget presentation. I kind of want to keep a focus on the evening. So we're going to talk about that tonight. You've seen this. This is matches last week's. Okay, so this is different from the weeks prior, because now we know the number, and we can throw in the assessment number, we can throw in our tax rates that we're calculating and all that kind of stuff. We still have a range in there of tax rates that would result from this proposed budget. The range is obviously in there. We talked a little bit last week about some things that we could do to maybe bring the spending down a little bit, if that's where we decide to go. If we leave it right where it's at, you're at the 816 per thousand of assessed value, and that difference is 30 cents per thousand, making about a $15 a year difference. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit. Is there any questions on this one? I'm going to come back to this at the end, but you've seen it, right? So, again, we've seen this. We know the taxable value now. We know that it's up about, you know, $50 million. So a lot of that is new construction. Or there's the 67 in new construction as well. So anyway, we've seen this before. This isn't all that new for us. Questions out before I move along? I'm trying to go quick because it's almost 8 o'clock. okay, so this graph we saw last year as well, this represents the tax rates over the last several years. The two in green at the end are the low if we reduce that spending a little bit, and the high if we keep it where it is. And they show you how those compare to prior years. They would both be highs either way over the last, since fiscal year 07. So, but there, it shows you the range now that might compare with other years in the recent past. Again, not a new table. We looked at this last week. Nothing's changed there. And some of the spending options. So right now there's a little less than a $300,000 surplus that hasn't been actually appointed to any kind of a purpose in the budget for spending. There are some needs out there that we haven't yet addressed in our budget as well. We talked about some of those last week, victim witness coordinator. Maybe we decide to run the pool. Some of those kinds of things might dip into that $300,000. But if we wanted to, we could reduce it by one or by two or by all three. And those, that's the difference that we would see. It would go from the 812 per thousand to the 803 per thousand assessed value. this shows the homeowner's exemption and what it's been doing over the last several years since fiscal year 07. Right now we're expecting, or it's been decided, we got a $94,745 homeowner's exemption. And what that does to actually your tax rates, if the average homeowner with the median value house last year would have had a $566 burden. This year we've got the three different rates there. If we kept it all the money that's in the budget now, all the revenue that's in the budget now, $578, almost $579. And if we reduce that by that $300,000, it would go down to $572. But that doesn't tell you the whole story. That's for the median value home. Some homeowners might actually see a decline in their tax burden. This is for the same calculation for a $200,000 value home. And in all three situations, we still see a reduction in the tax burden for that home. So the median household value only shows you a little bit of the story. Again, both of those calculations you saw last week as well. Any questions on that before I move on? Because now I'm going to start getting into the two focus areas, right? So again, accessible community. This one talks about how our effective planning and our timely investments are helping us address the needs of an expanding and a changing population. We need to be integrating our balanced transportation systems. We just spent a little bit talking about sidewalks and finding other ways of transportation. We're still committed to high levels of maintenance. And we want to have convenient access to our residents. And that's really the heart of this focus area. And to address those goals in the strategic plan, we've done some things. We're proposing some things in the budget, and it's missing the bottom of it again, just barely. There's no new personnel in the budget that's kind of aimed at this one, but there is an upgrade to one position in the planning department from a planner to a senior planner. The idea being that we can get some more skilled growth out of one of our planner positions that might take on some more complicated, bigger projects. We're in a position now where we're able to do that, where we've got the third planner position, which, by the way, we've hired and will be here in the next couple of weeks. And so we'll have three planners on board, and I think that's a great place to be. And if we can get one of those guys to be, you know, taking on some of these more complicated tasks like comprehensive plan stuff and code amendments and really taking a larger comprehensive look at the planning issues, not just reviewing plans every day, then we think we'll see a benefit from that in the goals for accessible community. So that's the only expense, $4,800 for an upgrade to a position for personnel. Capital.
Mitch, yeah. Suzanne has it.
Sorry. Explain to me more what the difference is between a planner and a senior planner. Do they have more education? Do they have more years work experience? What qualifies somebody to be senior versus right. just a planner?
So, yes. No, they don't. Probably the biggest thing I would tie it to would be experience. So a new planner, the guy that we just hired who's coming, has got about a year of experience. He's got a bachelor's degree in planning. That's about what we had when we hired Jonathan, about a year with a bachelor's degree. As you get more experience and more real-world kind of application of it, eventually you can actually become a certified planner. And that, to me, is the key. The AICP, the American Planning Association, is kind of the national group of planners out there. And you can go through the American Planning Association and become a certified planner. And right now, the only certified planner in Twin Falls is me. I do very little in the planning department anymore.
Gotcha.
And we need somebody with that level of expertise who can get the degree and the experience and then go test. It's a pretty complicated certification. You got to have that certification in order to even, I think, be considered for a senior planner position. So there's that. And then the duties that be assigned to them would be more those higher level type policy creation or code creation kind of duties. A lot of the role that I played several years ago in the planning department and have much less time and ability to do now. So, but yeah, I think primarily the difference is experience. It's time on the job.
Okay, thank you.
Probably also give them a slight supervisor type role over the other planners. So there's an opportunity for career advancement and growth in the position too, which helps with our attraction and retaining quality, talented folks. So, anything else on that? Okay, we've also got some capital expenses in the accessible community goals, and we just spent a little while talking about those top two with ADA compliance and sidewalk replacement program. And so those are some good programs. The ADA compliance one, we've got those money now. We're just continuing that again next year. The sidewalk replacement program is new. We're going to give that a shot. I think it's going to be a good program. I hope that we see a lot of success with that. We're going to reconstruct some more of East and Drive South. This would pick up where this current project, you know, we're currently doing that right now down to right, or about a little further south than right, as far as the money will take us.
this project would continue it. And then another section of Easton Drive from Julieta Falls. It's a little bit other side of town, right on the north side. We got to put some streetlights in along North College and or along Cheney between North College and Washington. This is the place where we're going to talk about the ARF vehicle. ARF vehicle is really about the airport, and the airport is really about accessibility to the community. And so the ARF vehicle, keeping our airport safe and accessible, and that's where the taxiway reconstruction comes in as well. So those two projects represent, you know, $3.5 million worth of improvements at the airport that are going to be, what was the number again, 93 point, the percentage funded by the federal government. Right, so a lot of that money is anyway, so those accessible community. Any questions on these before I move to environmental?
So there are a few questions here. So yep. I have a question. Maybe John can chime in on this one. So the Eastland Drive South project. So after that piece, how much more of Eastland Drive South is left?
You're talking about, Eastland Drive South.
Yeah, the right to Osterlo.
So that would complete piece. The stretch from the mile from Kimberly
to Orchard.
Orchard. That's the intent. What's left on the north? Yeah, then we go north.
Yeah, then you have to do the north. So my question was specific to the south of Kimberly Road. So, Chris Talkington.
And I think you kind of alluded to the ARF vehicle and that taxiway that there's a lot of federal money in this. Right. This is not local property tax dollars. Like when 90-95%, I think, is outside.
93.25% federal government.
Of course, you would know that, Laurie.
Don Hall.
So on that, so the 93%, whatever, of the 3 million something.
Uh-huh.
The other part is ours.
Ours and the county's share.
7%.
And I think we're also planning to use some of the airport, the passenger fees to cover some of that as well.
So the 3 point whatever million. Is the total package.
The total cost.
And we have 7% of it.
Yeah.
Okay. And then streetlights on.
6.75%.
6.75%. Thank you for that clarification. It's very important. Streetlights on Cheney. The only question I have about that is I know that when we did Falls Avenue, the streetlights along Falls west.
Right. West of Washington.
You could land a 747.
It's
on
pretty
that road
bright.
Now
because bright.
I like it.
Are we going to be doing the same thing? Seemed to me like it was overkill.
And so we did that project, and then shortly after that, we put some streetlights in along Washington North, which were not quite as 747-ish.
Right.
We've spent some time doing surveys that Jackie has run through that process and trying to figure out what exactly is right and wrong. And it's not going to be the Falls example. It'll be probably much more like the Washington example, the Washington North.
Thank you. Suzanne Hawkins.
So just because we're talking about lights on Cheney Drive, we have for some time talked about the need for light on the corner of Cheney Drive and Parkview. That is a horrible, horrible intersection. And at night, with the angle that those roads come together, you cannot see. And it seems like it keeps getting kicked down the road. And I just like to throw that back out there. It is a dangerous intersection at night. By the LDS school and the hospital kitty corner, and then you have the bank there.
Right.
And it is not easy.
The intersection is poorly lit. And I remember a recent meeting that came up here, and Jackie was here, and what she explained was, there's like kind of a weird gap in our code where a residential subdivision developer is required to put up lights and maybe a commercial one wasn't. So we might just need to bite the bullet and budget for that.
Something needs to happen there before somebody gets hurt.
So we've got a note.
Thank you.
Any other questions on the accessible community components?
Environmental is going to go fast. our strategic plan focus number 5 is environmental community. We do have an unparalleled natural setting here. I think you'd be a fool to try and argue that point. We have an ongoing commitment to maintain that natural setting. Through you know, doing so, we can expand our economic vitality. We can set ourselves apart from the other cities in Idaho that don't have this unparalleled natural setting. We need to do what we can to maintain and to keep that up, and to maintain our clean water and our clean air and all those other kinds of things. And so much of what so many of our departments are going to do is exactly that. I mean, the problem that it's not very exciting to talk about here because it's just a lot of operational expenses. So we have engineering department, planning, zoning department, we have building inspections department, which I didn't list up there, parks and recreation, water, wastewater. We had all these departments who a lot of what they do every single day is getting at keeping our water clean, getting rid of the wastewater, managing the development along the rim, putting in trails, finding alternate ways of transportation that reduces emissions. I mean, all these kinds of things is just the everyday operations of so many of our departments. But when it comes right down to it, we're not really hiring any new personnel in this proposed budget to further those goals. We just have a bunch of good people doing a good job now. And we have a little bit of a capital expense, and that's continuing a tree enhancement program that our Parks Department offers. Trees are a fantastic addition from an environmental standpoint for our community, and we need to keep up that program. So that's really the only non-operational expense that we can really talk about with this proposed budget. But again, operationally speaking, we're not forgetting this goal. We are absolutely pushing forward. Any questions about environmental community? No.
Okay. I see none.
We're going to go right back to this table. Again, talk about our tax rate. With the proposed level of spending at its current rate, it'll lead us to the 816 per 1,000 of a taxed 1,000 taxable value. Utility rates are all included on this table as well. This shows you the 5% increase to sewer, the other increases that we talked about to water and sanitation. The total impact to the average utility user is $1.81 per month. The total annual impact, or the total monthly impact for the The total annual impact for the tax, property tax, is going to be $15.52 if this budget were to be adopted as proposed. And I'll kind of conclude with there. Actually, I have one more slide. This just tells you the rest of the month's schedule for these kinds of conversations. This is the last night we're going to talk about strategic plan focus areas. Next week, we'll have a public hearing on the rate adjustments, if there are any. Okay, so we'll have new fees. Next week, we'll probably have time on the 22nd. It's not up there for continued discussion or questions, if there are any. But the 29th is really when we have the hearing and we potentially adopt the final budget. On the 15th, we'll also do the adoption of the preliminary budget. And so that's what we have to look forward to for the next few weeks. And now, is there any other questions?
Greg Lanting.
Could you go back two slides?
Yeah, to the tax table.
Yeah, it might be a little clearer to the public and maybe even me. If we've got monthly at the bottom and we've got yearly in the middle, and so if we had either both of them yearly or both of them monthly, at least on one of the slides somewhere along the line. Okay, it doesn't have to be every week, but just so we can see the total, because we like to look at the total cost. Although that is, I see the point though, is that tax rate is not really the total cost, is it? So,
because you're taxes. So,
well, I guess that middle the middle one is the total taxable amount,
annual tax.
So that would be a yearly increase of $6.02. So if we had that, you know, so you'd say, well, the average household is going to have an increase of $3.10 or whatever it is.
The idea there is that the tax burden is an annual burden, and you got to pay those utility bills every month.
Yeah, now, I understand.
So it kind of makes sense. You know, I mean, when we're putting the thing together, it makes sense to do it that way, but I also see where we can try to break that out too. Anything else?
So next week, do we set the maximum?
Yeah, so when you set
next week,
that's right. So as Mitch shared, next week you will set the preliminary budget, and the preliminary budget is going to be the maximum amount that you will elect to spend in the next fiscal year. And also next week we'll set the public hearing for the 29th. We've, as you received your tax notices and your assessments, we share with the county very early on when that date's going to be, and so we'll ask for you to just confirm that date on the 29th of August as the official public hearing, and then that evening we'll have you adopt the budget. So next week, no public hearings associated with rates. Anything that we do with sanitation will come later as we have a new contract and what that looks like. So next week it is just setting the maximum spending. And what's important about that amount is you don't need to make decisions, as Mitch was talking about, on that $300,000 unless you're ready to. If you want to continue to use that and use the next 2 weeks to kind of have that conversation of whether or not you incorporate that or not, or any other changes that we have not covered in the budget. And as Mitch shared, this kind of concludes our connection to the strategic plan. Next week it's going to be an overview. And on the 22nd, it's going to be more of a Q&A if you have questions about the budget in terms of what that looks like. We want to have a final budget ready to go so that the citizens have a really good understanding of what is being proposed as in almost as close to final form prior to that additional citizen input.
So I was actually going to ask about the unallocated funds and when would be the best time to maybe have some further presentation from staff about that and further discussion on it.
We are in a position to do that next week, to talk about what that additional $300,000 that has not been appropriated, what that could go forward with. It'll be kind of like a menu of options. I think that we probably have more than $300,000 that could be included on that list just because of the number of reductions that we've made along the way to present a balanced budget to you. And so we will be in a position to share that next week, and then you can take the next couple of weeks to digest that, make those decisions, and ultimately produce a budget that you're comfortable with.
I would find that helpful as we're setting the maximum amount for next week, and then that also gives a little bit of time for the public to maybe understand those a little more before the public hearings, if everyone's kind of okay with that. Chris Talkington.
And if I recall, that $300,000, not to have it or to include it, represents a shift from about 803 to 816.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Any other comments for Mitch or the staff on the budget? So we do give the opportunity for the public to give some input. So is there anyone here who would like to address the council on either tonight's presentation on the budget or the budget in general? Yes, please come on forward, sir. If you please just state your name and address for the record.
Ken Wiesmore, 2451 Ironwood, Twin Falls. My question is, I hear from DMV employees where there's a need for a stoplight. Maybe they're on Hankins Road, and right there on Addison and Hankins. And how do they go about getting such a thing and even getting it on an agenda or something in the future? Because they're saying that accidents have increased there. And the manager, I was talking with him, and he says that, it's ridiculous. It gets plugged up. People can't get in and out of the store because they're backed up on either side. But
right.
I just wanted to know the process.
So. Okay. So that item, actually, as we've discussed that one before, and it's sort of in process, and perhaps someone on staff can let us know where that is in the discussion phase. And
yeah, we'll do that. And so as you're aware, we have about 20 different stoplights that have been programmed through the capital improvement process. Our engineering team goes through an annual review of different warrants, what is approved, and then takes and funds or provides a funding plan for the most critical We'll connect with Jackie Fields, our city engineer, tomorrow and get a list, and then we'll also respond to Mr. Weismore. We'll do also publicly next week and get that email out to the council.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else who would like to address the council on the budget? Seeing no one, we will move on to the next item on the agenda, which is items from the city manager or the city council. Travis, any items from you? Excellent. Chris Talkington.
I'd like to report urban renewal met today at noon and have approved in principle moving ahead with a public hearing on a $17 million-plus dollar budget. It's going to be an interesting and critical time for urban renewal, and I think we should be real thankful we have Phil Kuchlin guiding us through an area that, with his expertise, he can avoid a lot of very costly mistakes. We're at the point right now that they did everything from discuss the $100,000 that has been included for art projects on Main Street to interfacing the city's project of the plaza and the city hall with the five blocks. There are little areas of contact we have to get down and literally measure within a few feet or whose split responsibility it is for both utilities and improvements. Talked about some utility problems we're having, but right now I think that it says clean for going to public hearing and justifying the process as we can expect, and encourage us all to attend that public hearing if we can.
Thank you, Chris. I would just quickly report that Suzanne and I had the opportunity to attend the open house over at Rock Creek Elementary today for that new school that will open next week. Go Raptors. And then tomorrow, the school district will be having an open house from 4 to 6 at Pillar Falls Elementary out on Hankins and Stadium. So good to see those projects coming along, and they had a huge crowd, huge turnout today at those. So as school gets ready to start, let's all start paying attention to how we drive around town and slow down and figure out where the new stoplights are, because there's a couple of those now, too. So anything else from the council? Seeing nothing, meeting is adjourned.